Good morning, buenos dias. Let's kick this off this morning. This is a spectacular crowd. I mean, we had a way to get you sit up front. That's a really good idea. My name is Fernando Giraldo, and I'm the chief of Santa Cruz County Probation. And we're very happy to see you all here and take part in this. Just looking at the group of folks, many of you I know and have worked with over the years. There's a lot of new faces here. I'm really happy to see what I believe are students, probably from a lot of different schools, so thank you. Yes, okay, at least one was brave enough to raise their hand. So that's fantastic, because I hope that this can be a learning experience for you. That's part of why we're here today. So it's an honor for me to be able to open up our work with James Bell and the W. Haywood Burns Institute, but I have a few remarks prepared that I before we go into that. For most of my nearly 20-year career at probation, we've been working alongside our partners and community partners to improve outcomes for youth and families in the juvenile justice system. I'm proud to say that as a result of our innovative work locally over the past 20 years, our department is a national model site for detention reform through the Annie E. Casey's Juvenile Detention Alternatives Initiative, and some of you may know that. 17 years ago, we started towards a path of transforming our system by safely reducing unnecessary detention for youth, developing community capacity to create detention alternatives, improve conditions of confinement for youth that are in custody, and also work on the very important issue of reducing racial and ethnic disparities throughout our system and throughout the justice system. Along the way, our work has been supported by the Annie E. Casey Foundation, as well as funding from a variety of sources, state and federal, one of those being the Board of State and Community Corrections, DMC, which is a disproportionate minority contact grant that we are supported by that for 6 years, and we continue to support our work to reduce disparities currently with other funding. For us locally, this has resulted in several years of technical assistance with the W. Haywood Burns Institute to increase our internal capacity to collect, analyze, and interpret data to make informed decisions regarding practices and policies, to engage internal and external stakeholders in the work of reducing disparities, and to provide assistance to other jurisdictions working in this very important area. While we have made significant progress and influenced a number of jurisdictions across the country, we still have work to do. The overrepresentation of youth of color at all points in our system continues to be an issue. This morning, the population in juvenile hall was 20. For the past month, the average daily population has been 14. It's nearly a historical low for us in many years. So that's really good news, far fewer youth in detention. But I will share this. Of those 20 youth, 18 youth were youth of color, Latino youth. That's 90% of the youth in detention are youth of color. So that is something that we need to continue to work on. So this is part of the reason we are here today. A discussion about racial and ethnic disparities that exist in the juvenile justice system is often overlooked, but it is of the utmost importance. Unfortunately, this topic is often, you know, overlooked, ignored, or denied. We as practitioners, students, community members, policymakers need to make sure that we are deliberate in creating equitable opportunities for youth and families we serve. We must take action and begin by carefully examining our systems, and we're talking today about the educational system and the justice system, by using data and making decisions through a racial and ethnic lenses. The topic of racial and ethnic disparities in the education and justice system often makes people a little uncomfortable, maybe defensive, maybe feel guilty. But this is okay, because we should be uncomfortable with the information I just gave you about the 90% of youth in detention that are Latino. This is something we continue to work on, but we can't do it alone. That's why it thrills me to see all of you here. This is collective impact. I'm honored to have James Bell, Executive Director and Founder of the W. Haywood Burns Institute, join us this morning to discuss the very important topic regarding racial and ethnic disparities. In a few moments, we will officially introduce Mr. Bell. We extended an invitation to have James join us because it is a very important time here in the community of Santa Cruz. Many of you may be aware that the Criminal Justice Council, or known as also as the CJC, convened a youth violence prevention task force about 2 years ago. I have been fortunate to be part of that, along with Megan Joseph, the community organizer, and staff from the Applied Survey Research. Through the commitment of a broad cross-section of community stakeholders and policymakers, the task force is on its way to developing a 3 to 5 year strategic youth violence prevention plan. Many of you here today are participating in the strategic planning process, some of you since the start, when we identified important indicators that we believed could gauge the level of well-being and safety and the safety that our youth are experiencing in the community. The first major achievement was the Status on Youth Violence report, which we released last December, and it reported out on those indicators of well-being. Since the release of the report, we've been working fast and furiously using the results-based accountability process, RBA. We might talk a little bit about that today. And we've done this to identify the results that we want for our community with respect to preventing youth violence. Many of you here today are participating in the 3 work groups or are members of the steering committee that are accomplishing and contributing so much by bringing your knowledge, expertise, and passion to the youth violence prevention plan. So I thank you for that. In a moment, Megan will describe the work of the task force in more detail. As we begin the youth violence prevention strategic planning process, we're very close to start writing the plan. We must be sure that any interventions or practices, policies used to address youth violence, consider the impact that they will have on youth of color. There are strong and supportive voices in our work groups who've appropriately insisted that any new interventions or policies adopted by the plan also consider and address racial and ethnic disparities. I'll now have Megan Joseph, the Director of Community Organizing through the United Way, come up and talk a little bit about the Youth Violence Strategic Plan in a little bit more detail.
Good morning. Who else is really excited to be here? Woo! Awesome. I am too. When I first got here about 3 years ago to Santa Cruz County, I kept going around to everywhere that I had to speak and said, there is so much going on here. There's so many collaboratives. There's so much work that people are doing together. And that theme has not stopped. I was just talking with Sam Farr the other day, our congressman, and for this effort, we're doing key informant interviews with a lot of elected officials. And he said the same thing. He said, if there's so much going on in Santa Cruz County, and if we could break down the silos and you could do what it looks like you want to do in this plan, you're going to be light years ahead of everybody else. I think that's a pretty good omen for our plan. But it takes a village, and it doesn't take just a plan. A plan is necessary but not sufficient to actually reduce youth violence. So I want to put a caveat on this planning process that we know that's what it is. It's a planning process. And after that, it's going to take all of us and more to implement it. And I'll talk more about that as well. So along those same lines, as there's so much going on here, Fernando and I sat down about 2 years ago, and he was tasked with bringing this task force together under the CJC. And we both said, there's so much going on here. How do we break down some of these silos and figure out who's on first and who's doing what and why and how it all fits together so that we could have a comprehensive plan? And that is why we brought people together. So let me go through some of the slides. We brought people together to really decide what we wanted to do as a collective group to have the impact that we wanted to have, rather than so many efforts happening, amazing efforts, but disconnected efforts. This is the mission statement for the group that really came out of our first summit in 2012 and emerged out of the work groups. So in Equitable and United County, where all youth are engaged in family, school, and community, all youth have a sense of safety and well-being, youth feel they have a voice or are empowered to use it, and where all youth are able to access opportunities for successful transition into adulthood. And you'll see that each of our work groups and the work we're doing addresses each one of those pieces of our mission statement. So it's lofty. Some would say it's a vision statement, and we're committed to making it happen. So some of you were at this original summit where we teed off this conversation. I think it was the first time, or at least the first time in a while, that everyone came together from across the county, across sectors, from law enforcement to former gang members to youth to teachers, and everyone in between, to talk about what was really going on. We provided a venue for people to say what they thought the barriers were, what weren't we talking about as a community that we needed to talk about, and what were our successes already that we could leverage. And we brought all of that together and actually formed our planning process. Any good planning process starts with understanding what's already happening. So we spent a full year with our amazing partners, Applied Survey Research, with a lot of support from probation, with support from Packard, with support from the local chiefs association, and endless hours of in-kind time and support from the community to select indicators that we thought were important. And we're not just talking about crime rate. We're not talking about what's going on for the youth and their behavior. We're talking about our community's behavior. What are the adults doing that are getting in the way? What systems and policies have we put in place that are blocking our youth success? What is it our community doing in our environment that we can change? So we wanted to look at it all. We wanted to look at how to support families, how to support schools, the whole gamut, a very holistic view. So we put that together. There's executive summaries in the back table. And that full report is available on Applied Survey Research and United Way's website if you're interested. Once we got that lay of the land, we were able to move into developing the strategic plan. Through our community summits and work groups that have been amazing at being consistent and coming every month to work with us, we're starting to develop our planning. And we are using results-based accountability. What the heck is that? It's a very complex yet simple system. And people that have gone through all these work groups are kind of saying that. They're starting to be like, oh, I kind of get it now. All right. And what it really does is it aligns a large group like we have under a set of results so that we can all be moving forward together. And once we've identified the results, then we identify the indicators that we'll use to measure those results. What are the trends in our community? Why is it that one youth is doing better than another? And then we tell the story of that. Once we see what the data says, what's the story behind the trend? A data point's a data point. It needs a story. And there's 100 different stories to one data point. So what do we agree on? What are the trends that we agree on in this community that tell the story of what's happening right here? And then we're going to move into a process around November, December of picking strategies. That's going to be the hard part, right? We all have programs we love. We all have programs we think work. We all have things that we'd like to see happen. And that's where we come together and really ask the hard questions. What's really working? What do we want to see leverage that's already working here? And what do we need? What are the gaps? And what do we want to recommend? That will then move to the CJC for approval. We'll be going to each jurisdiction to have them adopt the plan. So we want as much buy-in from you and everyone else in our community as possible so that this can be owned by everyone and that we can all go out there and then implement it. And then we'll be implementing the strategic plan from April 2015 on. And that's where we'll really need you to come walk with us. So we've got three main areas that we're focusing on. Underneath that, we've got a lot of sub-areas. So one of the main areas is promoting positive child and youth development. So how do we support youth to be successful? See, there's some of the areas that fall underneath that. And we do, we're emerging with a set of results that we've all agreed upon and a set of indicators that we'll be publishing soon. We also have fostering safe and vibrant neighborhoods. So we know that it's not just supporting youth, but it's also creating an environment in their community that supports their success and that supports everyone's safety. So we're looking at these issues under that topic area. And then ensuring supported and functioning families. We knew in our community that we also needed the family to be involved. This is the area where we have the least data, the least number of indicators, but we know it's important, and so we're going to make it happen. So we're looking at family caregiver engagement, support, access to services, and other issues. These were some of the general findings. And again, you'll see it's interesting, but it doesn't tell a story yet. And we want to flesh this story out with everyone here. So we see that there was a rise in juvenile misdemeanor arrests for weapons. We know that's going to be a big piece of our plan. We know that might not even be on here, but we know that our youth employment rate is down by nearly 25%. That's definitely going to be something that we're looking at. We know we have disparities in graduation rates. So there's a lot of issues here and in the plan that are already arising as we know there's something here and we want to find out more about it. So ultimately, like I said before, this is a planning process, and it's necessary, it's an absolutely necessary tool in our toolbox for ending and preventing youth violence. But it's not sufficient for sustainable change. We know that we need to then go out there and work together to implement this plan to the best of our ability, and we think that efforts like these, like bringing James in to talk about critically important aspects of this plan, that we know if we produced a plan that didn't talk about critical things like truancy, we'd be doing the entire community an injustice. And if we don't, if we have a plan that's produced in a few months that doesn't talk about racial and ethnic disparities, we are doing the community a huge injustice. So we're here trying to put the pieces together. And we're really grateful that you're here with us. Thank you.
Yeah, I always wanted to hang out backstage, and that was very cool. But don't get any ideas. I'm okay, and I can finish this. I just raise of hands for those of you that participated in the Youth Violence Prevention Task Force. Come on, raise them up. Look at all that. Wow, that's pretty cool. And I think there'll be perhaps some new ones that we can engage in this really powerful process. So thank you. What you saw up there is really your work in the three areas that we focus on and the results. So just you should all give yourself a round of applause because it's amazing. Now it's time to introduce our special guest that we have today. Let me find that little bio here. Now you're wondering what I did back there. No. James Bell is the founder and executive director of the W. Haywood Burns Institute, since and otherwise also known as the BI. That's what we like to use here, because I think we're in with the BI. Since 2001, Mr. Bell has been spearheading a national movement to address racial and ethnic disparities in the juvenile justice system. The BI, which is named after civil rights pioneer W. Haywood Burns, was recently awarded the prestigious MacArthur Award for Creative and Effective Institutions. The award is presented to select organizations worldwide that have made a remarkable impact in their fields. Mr. Bell and his colleagues at BI work with juvenile justice systems across the country to reduce the disproportionality of youth of color. Mr. Bell guides the BI's Community Justice Network for Youth, also known as CJNY, a national network of programs working successfully with young people of color. Mr. Bell also works closely with the Casey Foundation's Juvenile Detention Alternatives Initiative, JDAI, jurisdictions, and the MacArthur Foundation's Models for Change Initiative. He received his JD from Hastings College of Law. Now, we're really lucky here in Santa Cruz because we've been working with James for as long as we've been doing detention reform. Prior to his work with the Haywood Burns Institute, or founding the Haywood Burns Institute, we were working with him at the start. And our formal chief, Scott McDonald, I talked to him last night and reminded me and I was just a little guy at probation, so you know, I wasn't aware of exactly what was going on 20 years ago. But James was instrumental in helping us start our reforms way back then. So it's just not nearly in the last 7 or 8 years that we've been working with James. Many of you have heard James speak. He's been here before, worked with our department. We've put together a lot of community groups and stakeholder groups to engage you all in this important process. Today, I also, we have a little surprise for James. We want to celebrate the work that we have done and what we will continue to do. So I have something here for James. Where did James go? Is he here? Oh, he's backstage too. James, this is pretty cool. I have a proclamation from you.
Oh my goodness.
From the Santa Cruz County Board of Supervisors, and I want to read it to you. And it says
here.
Don't read the whole thing?
No.
Okay, I won't. Honoring James Bell and the W. Haywood Burns Institute And this is really about honoring the work that we have done in a number of areas over the years with the BI, and it's signed by the Chair of the Board of Supervisors, Zach Friend, for today's special event. So this is an honor. We're pleased to just have been working with you and continue and look forward to it. James, here you go.
Thank you,
brother. You bet, buddy.
What a nice surprise. Hope it helps me with my parking ticket that I'm gonna get. Y'all ain't got no parking around here, man. I thought San Francisco was bad. So good morning, everybody. What a pleasure to be here and to be invited. It's always an honor to be invited to speak to people who, many of you in this room, could be up here speaking as well. And so I always see it as a privilege to be able to give these remarks and to have people sit and listen to my thoughts and my musings. So in that regard, I'd like to thank Fernando, Sarah, the Criminal Justice Council, the Youth Violence Prevention Task Force, for inviting me to share some ideas and information with you about the landscape of youth justice and education throughout the country, and where Santa Cruz County may fit into that mosaic. I want to begin by saying that no model system in justice or education exists without there having been a healthy tension, which was mentioned earlier, I'm so pleased you guys mentioned that, between community folks, young people, and the system shot callers. This tension, when healthy, keeps child-serving systems dynamic, active, and engaging the issues that are required for us to have a civil society that meets the challenges of the second decade of the 21st century. I believe that Santa Cruz has managed this tension pretty well, certainly managed it better than Cook County, where people just throw grenades at each other. But make no mistake about it, the healthy tension is required. So I thank the community groups, BU, law enforcement, people that have vested interests in young people but come from different perspectives to try to make sure that we have the kind of civil society that we need. Addressing the needs of children in this county cannot be quarantined from the larger tableau that all youth-serving professionals and the communities they serve have to engage. In the words of our Attorney General here in California, Kamala Harris, nothing is more important than how we keep our families and each other safe. Today, we are smarter and more informed about how this is done, but the question is, are we wiser as people or are we wiser as institutions? So I would like to begin my remarks by recommending the asset-based approach that the youth violence prevention process is focused on. It's the asset-based approach to children, youth, and families as one that is forward-looking and I would argue necessary at this time in our nation's history. Why do I say that? Because as many law enforcement officials, school superintendents, child welfare administrators have said in a variety of jurisdictions across the country, if you're listening, they are saying we cannot arrest, incarcerate, adopt, or suspend and expel ourselves out of the issues presented by young people and families in need of services and interventions. You just can't do it. There's not enough cells, there's not enough policemen, there's not enough kids to suspend. We have to do something differently, and I'm gonna make that case. Increasingly in California and across the country, those families and communities will be people of color. As you can see, in California, 70%, this doesn't show you that, but you can see by 2040, people of color. Now, we Californians have been a majority state of people of color for about 10 years. We are joined by three other states in the nation, Hawaii, New Mexico, and Texas. So we at the Burns Institute have shed the use of the word minority, because what hell sense does it make to say majority minority? That's just not future oriented, and it's stupid, really. And in California in particular, where we live, with people in this room, 70% of the people under 25 in this state are young people of color. 70% of the people under 25. Numbers like that require that in child-serving systems, the equity mandate should be also given the proportionate emphasis that our population requires. In fact, fairness and equity should not be seen as some kind of luxury, as some kind of thing on the side, as some kind of bonus you get when you buy the DVD player. No, but it is a necessity. It is more importantly, actually, the preferred approach to community safety, which is the case that I'm going to make today. Our work involves engaging communities and systems professionals to change hearts, minds, policies, and practices so that when a five-year-old throws a temper tantrum in preschool, handcuffs will never be a part of the adult response. Now, Dr. Bob Ross, president of the California Endowment, wrote in the LA Times recently, "Imagine walking into a newborn nursery ward at an American hospital, and you see 100 babies in their bassinets. You are then informed that 65 of these babies will then spend their time in jail or prison. Our country's future is inextricably interwoven to these 65 young people. These 65 bassinets are a part, an integral part, of our country's future. We will not succeed without them. You cannot run a country on the elite institutions in this nation. We cannot do it." Two books from different political perspectives addressing this issue are relevant. Robert Kagan, a noted neoconservative's book entitled The World America Made, and Fareed Zakaria, a noted progressive's book entitled The Post-American World 2.0, both examine the challenges facing us as a nation, our values, and the accountability of our democratic institutions as the world becomes smaller and more interconnected. Something's going on when you can get peaches in February. Even though these two men have different perspectives, they both agree that the institutions and structures that form the backbone of the American experience must adapt to the realities of a globalized, rapidly changing world. The backbone that supports our values as a republic are fairness and equity in civil society's public institutions, regardless of status. The delivery of healthcare, education, mental health, child welfare, and justice should never be determined by someone's geography, status, ability, or orientation. Services in North County and South County should not be determined by where you live. Not only is it unfair, but it renders us unable to compete as a nation, and here I would say as a county. Now, it may have bureaucratic short runs, it may be convenient, it may feel good for the minute, for the short term, but in the long run, we as a society will pay. What do I mean? This is the first time since World War II wherein we are no longer the world's leaders in education or middle class income, according to a recent study reported by the New York Times. It's the first time American middle class is not number one in the nation. So we used to say, yeah, we're dumb, but we're rich. Because we've been behind in education for a while. Can't say that anymore. Yeah, we're dumb and we're getting poorer. I believe that the words of my friend and colleague, Paul Farmer, are instructive when he states that the protection of rights are not accidents. They are not random in distribution or effect. Rather, they reflect symptoms of deeper pathologies of power and are intimately linked to the social conditions that so often determine who will suffer abuse and who will be shielded from harm. Who will suffer abuse and who will be shielded from harm? Which takes us to Girls' Night Out. Last year, newspaper article, I think you guys can read this. We got 5 teenage girls busted during a girls' night out. When the CHP pulled them over in a Toyota, weaving between lanes at 2:20 in the morning. 15-year-old girl driving, she shouldn't have been driving. She only had a learner's permit. Other girls were 14, 16, 2 or 17. They found marijuana that they tried to hide in the Snapple bottle. Girls told their parents that they were going to each other's houses, but instead went to a hookah bar, not hooker, hookah, in San Francisco. Officers issued the girls a citation and released them. As you sit here, I want you to shout out to me what race or ethnicity you think these girls are.
White.
Okay, which is the answer I get everywhere I show this slide in the nation and the world. We can't have this, people. Would this happen with 5 Latinas? Absolutely not. We all know this. We cannot have this be the truth. I want to give you another anecdote in this. Who will be shielded from harm? I have a friend, like Fernando, we've gotten up there in age now. So my friends are actually, some of them are shot callers, right? And, Fernando's still trying to keep it real by playing in the band, but we all know that, you know, he's a probation officer, so, you know, he ain't gonna play but so good. So, I had to get that in. So, he's a chief probation officer in a major city. He's white. He's been on the job for 2 months. Tells his daughter, 16, who's going out with 2 of her friends, says, now I've been in this job 2 months. You know we have a curfew in this town. I don't want to read my name in the paper tomorrow morning. And his daughter looks at him and says, oh, don't worry, Dad. Those laws aren't for us. The kids know it. You think the kids don't know it? That you don't think the kids know when they see this who this is? And if this was 5 kids of another race or ethnicity, that they in fact would not get a citation and go home? For some folks, the changes in demographics seem scary. Bringing us to a us against them mentality or a zero-sum game. And that is, every advancement for a person of color means that somebody white has to lose. Look at the jobs that are happening. Manufacturing on a downward slope. Government jobs, downward slope. What's on the upward slope? Services. This is a changing economy. And in that kind of meta economy, the natural instinct is to stiffen, restrict, look for custody and control. And I'm saying today we must resist that urge. Heretofore, we as a country were willing to pay any price we believe was necessary for a seductive, but what I believe is a hollow phrase, but it's very seductive, and it's law and order. Who doesn't want law and order? Who wants anarchy and chaos? It's very seductive to say law and order. And pay we have. Between 1971 and 2000, the expenditures for incarceration have increased a whopping 313%. You can see all the money that is being spent there. Look at this gigantic ski slope in terms of who's behind bars. If you look, we have in the correctional population, not the 2 million behind, 7 million in the arms of the justice system, between probation, parole, all of that. 7 million people who effectively you've locked out of the job market, you've locked out of further education, and you want to compete? That's what happens when you lock people out and you have to bring people from countries all over the world to work in Silicon Valley because, quote, we don't have the talent here. It is a global economy, and what we do matters. So lest you think this is a liberal versus conservative issue, conservative Republicans opined in the Washington Post that states can, and I'm quoting, save costs without compromising public safety by intelligently reducing their prison populations. And going further to say that spending $68 billion on corrections should trouble, I quote, every American. I invite you to go to Right on Crime. Look at here in their, one of their publications, why fewer prisons are good for Texas's economy. Now, when you start talking fewer prisons in Texas, oh my God, the worm is turning. So if we choose to perpetuate the status quo, we will do so at great expense, and we will miss the opportunity to improve public safety. Indeed, of all people, the Tea Party has trained its eyes on justice and corrections by calling the prison system a government program that is too bloated and in need of reform. The Tea Party is equating the justice system to food stamps. Government program needs to be reformed. The worm has turned. Now, we as a nation have endured 400 years of experience with incarceration and its 60% failure rate. Interesting that we never asked the incarceration system to be evidence-based in order to get their funding. But those same county executives will ask our programs to be evidence-based to the umpteenth degree. Something a little funky about that. The ideas presented by being asset-based affords an opportunity to be smart on crime, but more importantly to me, tough on results, which this planning process seems to be trying to be. It brings into sharp relief the choice between employing the status quo by using retribution and detention, or investing in proven public safety outcomes driven by authentic methods to change behaviors. Status quo. And this picture here from the Chung May home was taken at the turn of the century. It doesn't look much different than detention now. And of course, our famous boy on the crate. What we need are methods that include a range of approaches, from mindfulness and spiritual connections to traditional therapies and relations. Jurisdictions like Santa Cruz and others are challenging themselves to assemble the elements that form the alchemy for positive behavior change for proven risk young people. That is, you recognize trauma, you provide wraparound services, and the thing that I think is hardest to do, you improve your systemic infrastructure to rid it of structural racism. Prevention, intervention. Now, no system has all the answers, and the panels that will follow my presentation will highlight the difficult issues here and the successful issues here, from detention reform to direct files to police community trust, all of these issues that are difficult. All of these issues should be approached with a clear-eyed, kinetic energy geared towards enhancing assets rather than focusing on deficits. And with so many young people, if we work with them, their deficits are so easily on display. Actually, what they've learned is to lead with their deficits. Come on, Iggy, you stupid. You know you stupid, man. Do that stupid thing you do. Yeah, that's it. Oh, I think that's my phone ringing. I thought I turned it off. I hate when people's cell phones go off. So rather than this easily looked at deficits, I always encourage probation officers and social workers that for every deficit they cite in their report, they must cite an asset. If you can't find a young person with assets, you don't know that young person. If you can't find a community with assets, I don't care how beat down, how far down it seems, I don't care if a flower ain't grown there in 3 years, there's an asset. It assists because what we really want to provide is tools for young people. Let's address the education sector for a moment. Here are the myths that exist in the school setting. One, race categories are biological realities. We are fundamentally different types of people. I can't even say how I'm just objected to that idea. Inequality today, now this is the one that lives. This is the new 20th century. It's economic, it's not racial. And I just want you to show me a neighborhood where most of the people that have all the money are people of color and the white folks are poor, okay? So I'll go. I might even try to find a crib there. But it's not happening. Myth three, some groups are smarter than others. Oh, I'd hate to be just an average Asian student. Oh my God, that's where the Asians have to live. Smart. They're just smarter than everybody else. Don't understand what's wrong with you Latinos and blacks. Look at them. Achievement is a result of culture's approach to school. This means that just showing disparities is not enough to trump the reality to deal with those myths. What we really want to provide is tools for young people to participate in this, positive, autonomous decision-making and behavior. Autonomous decision-making. It consists of having young people be motivated from within, as those people who have been successful are. Motivated from within. There was at some point a moment when your friends did something, and in order for you to be sitting here today, you stopped, or you're not doing it anymore. At some point, you have to stop smoking weed and study for the biology exam. That's what makes you successful. Because if you take the biology exam high on weed, who knows what your results may be? Highly unlikely to be effective. We want autonomous decision making where young people make the decisions themselves. It consists of having young people be motivated from within, promoting qualities such as creativity, leadership, altruism, and civic engagement. That's what we should be having young people do. In order to engage this approach, the justice sector in particular could look to other sectors to find innovations. Indeed, some folks find the words justice and innovation to be oxymoronic. But working with strengths affords the opportunity to make them synonymous. From the business world, Fernando's already stated what they've done here and what you guys are doing is ahead because you're using data to drive decisions, and I'll talk about that. From our work in approximately over 120 counties over the last decade, we have learned just how poor data collection is. Some systems cannot answer basic questions about what youth come into contact with the law, what offenses they're being admitted to detention for, how long they stay, and what interventions are tried in order to get them out, and if these interventions are effective. They just don't know the basic stuff of what they should know. Anybody here familiar with a food chain called Chipotle? Raise your hand if you've heard of Chipotle. Okay, you've heard of it. I ain't gonna ask you how many people ate there, but that's okay. Now, a few years ago, you may know, Chipotle began working on creating another new restaurant chain. Anybody know Chipotle's new restaurant chain? Shout it out if you know it. Okay. Can you imagine Chipotle going into another chain, a multi-gazillion dollar industry, and a new venture without data? Can you imagine Whole Foods not deciding in Santa Cruz County where to put their store? Was Whole Foods banging on Watsonville's doors for a store? Is Nordstrom banging on Watsonville's door for a store? But Mickey D's is. This is data. So, Chipotle's new chain is focusing on Pan-Asian food. So we got the Mexican down, now we're going for the Pan-Asian. They have opened 10 and it's called Shop House. S-H-O-P-H-O-U-S-E, Shop House. They've opened 10 Shop Houses in a few locations, clearly not here, where the data tells them they will be successful. If we can do this for potential noodle consumption, we can certainly do it for depriving people of their liberty. Santa Cruz County's probation department has been working on data to assist in developing services. I want to present some national data just for your education from the justice and education sectors. Referral data in the education section. You can see here what youth of color and referrals for white youth. If you notice, the white youth, it's much more concrete. Smoking, you're either smoking or you're not. Vandalism, you either got that hammer and you're beating the hell out of the locker or you're not. Leaving without permission, you're either here or you're there. Obscene language, well, we all know what that is. When you look at why kids of color are referred for suspension and expulsion, disrespect. Now that could be a wide range. Is rolling your eyes disrespectful? I don't know. I've seen some Latinas and black women that have made rolling their eyes a science. Woo, it's like 85 versions. I mean, they got it. Some of it may be disrespectful, but they ain't say nothing. There must be a class somewhere. How to be a woman of color and roll your eyes, because these fools are crazy, right? Excessive noise. They're so damn loud. Threat. Loitering. Use for data. We want to have data to inform and drive department policy, to understand your system, to define and refine your problems, to establish goals, and select effective strategies, which we've heard about this morning. And of course, you want to track progress. So here's our national data. In 1985, the youth justice system, for the students that are here, this will blow their mind. which is a term for somebody in my, me and Yolanda, we back in there, and he's like, it'll blow your mind. Kids are like, what the hell are they talking about? My mind ain't blown. So anyway, that was like, that's okay, I don't even want to explain it. Okay. So at that time, and if there were people here working, the youth justice system was 72% white. People can't even imagine a youth justice system that was 78% white. And by 2011, it's 71% kids of color. This is a sociological seismic earthquake. Now, let's take another look at that. Suppose the chart in 1985 and 2011 was the city you lived in. That you lived in a city that went from 85, 70% white, to 2011, 70% kids of color. People of color. Huge, huge impact. If you went before and you went back later, and all that that means. I just wanted to show you these rates. The U.S. is the highest incarcerator for young people of any other place in the world. You can see we're way up here. Everybody else, South Africa, a tremendously violent place, is way down here. So some people consider that an unfair comparison, and I understand that. I just wanted to show you where we are. Here are our national detention rates. This is not by percentage, this is by rates. And so you can see per 1,000 on a one-day count, out of 1,000 kids, if you're black, 167 of you are more likely to be in detention. If you're Native American, 88. Now, Latino is low at 69. And the reason for that is because we have a country that hasn't even started disaggregating Latinos from white folks. You can go many places in the country. I was in South Carolina. Now, I was born in South Carolina. And so I'm at a thing. And in the South, even though we have an increasing Latino population, most stuff is still defined as black and white. And so you go in, and I'm doing my presentation, and I say, how are you documenting Latinos? And the first thing they say is, well, we don't have no Mexicans here. I said, well, yeah, but what about any Dominicans, Cubans? I mean, it's like everything is. And they were like, no, we don't have any. Now, I have my rental car, and I'm driving by the chicken factory, and all I see in their rubber boots walking across the street to the parking lot are Latinos. I'm like, so what, do you guys just go blind for like 3 blocks while you're passing this factory? So first, we have to begin to disaggregate Latinos and what that means. And you guys can lead the country on how to do that. This is a one-day count to show you the kind of crimes that the justice system is dealing with nationally. For young people, you can see 70%, 76% or technical of status, property, drug, public order. 24% are violent or against a person. And in most jurisdictions, the violent crimes are probably 4% of the juvenile hall for those juvenile halls that are not having kids that are put into the adult system. So I wanted to show you the top 5 offenses in Santa Cruz. Of the young people that are detained there, 10 PC-211 are robberies, and you can see their various ethnicities. 6 are for placement failures. 3 AWOL, failure to appear. And we have 1 child in for murder, which is usually, that is always going to be lowest low. So if we took 6, 3, and 3, that's of those 12 kids, all of them are in for pissing off an adult. It's not exactly a public safety issue, but somebody has said, you need to be monitored. And this is not atypical if you look at data across the country. Now let's talk about disparities in school suspensions. As you can see, first-time offenders were suspended that were black at higher rates than first-time offenders for same minor offenses. Now, what black kids were in 2010, according to the Office of Civil Rights data, the black kids were really suspended for a display of affection. So I don't know what that is, but I don't know. They must be hot to trot or something, I don't know. They're disruptive, which might be a display of affection, who knows? Dress code, and then cell phone usage. So here are the rates of suspension for these categories. Now, Santa Cruz's probation department has been working on data to assist in developing the stuff that we are trying to address. Now, these numbers that I brought require an approach that adopts a notion of well-being, of fashioning strength-based approach to child's basic needs, regardless of circumstance. Children that have high service needs but demonstrate a low risk for public safety should be served in their communities. Communities are not only neighborhoods, blocks, meets, and bounds. Communities are shared interests and shared responses to objective conditions which need to encourage the idea of community, of belonging, of language and identity. This means that systems folk and community folk should work together. In order to do this successfully, we need to value communities, and deference should be paid to community values by anyone that's providing services. Therefore, we should encourage contacts with the communities that are positive and inclusive. We must forge new relationships with community groups, relatives, caring adults, and youth-serving organizations. I'm going to posit to you that this is one of the only true ways to unpack the ubiquity and hegemony of gangs in some of our neighborhoods. You must engage. It was over two centuries ago that Von Schiller gave us his immutable law of events, stating that into today already walks tomorrow. It should be the rare exception that today's toddler or student is tomorrow's detainee. Indeed, there is a significant growing critical mass of people that are demanding that child-serving systems become transformative rather than transactional. And in that vein, I propose that child well-being is the preferred public safety strategy, and I'd like to share some of those ideas with you. We here understand that our child-serving systems are not static, inanimate behemoths, but rather living organisms driven by societal norms that I believe are geared towards transaction and therefore increasingly missing the mark. Here on the dangers of detention, it's a source study that you can see, there are two of them now, that it does not work as a detention, it has profoundly negative impacts, and it's a predictor of commitment to state juvenile corrections. Can be. And what we're learning, you are at significant risk of this happening. Doesn't mean that it always happens. And what we're learning with the adolescent brain work that's coming out is that putting a kid in a 6x9 room may not be helpful at their point of adolescent development. And if you think about your parenting skills, that's not what you use the most. Okay, Johnny, you just flip me off, go into your 6x9 room where there's a computer, your TV, basically you have your own condo in your room. No, you interact, you intervene, you engage. Suspensions, similarly, do not increase school safety. This is research. You can see the sources. I'm going to cite you breaking school's rules. I'm going to break that up for you. It does not increase parental involvement. It does increase teacher turnover. And it does increase the likelihood of youth justice involvement. So these tools need to be examined. I'm not saying throw them away. Do the data. See what it's bringing you. So here, in order to combat this, I would like to insert two framing thoughts. Too often, we as a society incorrectly equate punishment with safety. And the other thought I would like to inject here is the ills of humanity are best cured by more humanity. With that conceptual framework, I would like to discuss some baseline information about childhood trauma and examine how the youth justice and education systems are responding to emerging information and discoveries. In a variety of local and national studies, data reveals that almost 70% of children had experienced a traumatic event by age 16. Of those, 40% reported violence as a source of the trauma. We here know that the numbers are significant enough to warrant attention, especially for children coming from communities of concentrated poverty. It is my observation that child-serving systems encounter this information with differing levels of awareness, knowledge, and skill. In order to be responsive to children and families, we need to be able to adapt to these emerging issues. So let me give you a quickie on trauma. Non-judicial drivers, and we can see here the intersection of childhood trauma, school discipline, and the youth justice system. Youth of color are likely to experience all three. All three. This is what we're learning about what we call from here to maturity. When you look at brain scans of the adolescent brain, we now know more about the adolescent brain than before. Why, when they're eating, does it sound like Jurassic Park? It's like you're not even chewing it. And then what do? Sleep, and keep sleeping, and sleep, and sleep some more. Why is it that the 14-year-old can't see that movie enough? Have you seen it 12 times? Yeah, I'm going for 13. I can actually tell you every line. It's a stage of development. It's hormonal. It's what they are going through. It's what we should know, that teenagers are different. Give you another example. So not only commercially, we count on teenagers. Every Friday night, who are we? We are Soquel. Who are we gonna beat? We're gonna beat whoever the hell they are. All right, let's go. Break a wall. Seventeen-year-old, I said, yeah, that's right. That sounds good. What are you gonna do? I'm a killer. The military counts on this stage of adolescent development. Okay, boys. Girls, you're 19. We're going to take Hill 55 right now. Let's go. Yeah. Now, when you're 35 and they say, okay, we're going to take Hill 55, you go, well, hold up, homie. Hold up. What's up atop of Hill 55? What can we expect? They got any drinks up there? Because I'm thirsty. You ain't doing the rah-rah. You're not doing the rah-rah. You ever see a pro basketball huddle when the coach is in the thing, the players are like, yeah, okay. I mean, it's like we're grown men. That stuff ain't working with us. So it is a normal stage of development, which I will not exempt. I will exempt for men midlife crisis and for women menopause with the personal summers. Hormonal stage of life. Here is the ACES study. Raise your hand if you've heard of the ACES study. Okay, this is pretty good. That's about 20% of the audience has heard of it. The prevalence of ACEs. The ACEs study, let me just give you a little information about that. What time is it?
10:30.
Okay, great. What we're gonna do is when I finish, which will be relatively soon, we'll just answer any questions that people have, and then we'll give you your break. Your booty's starting to get numb, so it's okay. So the ACEs study was stumbled into by physicians that were not looking at social ills at all. The ACEs study were done on upper middle class, white folks with health insurance. It was done by Kaiser. And what they found is that someone would come in at a young age, and when they would do their vitals, the vitals seemed to be totally out of whack for their age. And they were wondering, why would it be physically that you would have these symptoms at that age? So they went and they backed down the study, and this is what they found. Incarcerated household member, if they were sexually abused, a drug use problem, if you witnessed domestic violence, if you were physically abused, mental illness, separated or divorced family, drinking problems, and verbal abuse, 28%, the prevalence of individual ACEs. And so what they do is they give you the exam and you take the ACE test and see how many of these things happened to you or you experienced. If you have six or more ACEs, your life period is reduced by 20 years. Because you may not think you're dealing with it, but you're dealing with it. Who has seen the films done by California Endowment called Unnatural Causes? Okay, that was like two people. Unnatural Causes talks about, well, who has heard this axiom? If you tell me your zip code, I will tell you your life outcomes. I'll tell you how much you earn, how far you'll go in school, that kind of stuff. So one of the films in Unnatural Causes, and this is relevant, took a black woman living in Kentucky, I think it was, who was a pediatrician who got pregnant, living in the suburbs, moved out of the hood with her husband, thinking they're getting away from it. There's a high prevalence of low birth weight babies with black women. She knows about this. She's read the research. She's a pediatrician. She's upper middle class and gives birth to a low weight baby and can't believe it happened to her. And she wants to know, how did this happen to me? And so these are the kinds of questions that people are looking at in that regard. Now, how does trauma show up? In school, indifference, defiance, aggression, you can read that, results in suspensions and expulsions. In the community, those same kinds of things, in terms of trauma or toxic stress, indifference, defiance, aggression. So I'm not gonna go through the whole cortisol thing, but the more people are dealing with trauma and they aren't addressing it, it's showing itself and it ends up in our systems. And as you can see, when you go to the justice system, 90% have had at least one traumatic incident. So not clear what a 6x9 room's gonna do for that. Or we know we need to be aware of what we're doing. And here are the scholastic expectations. Confidence, focus, ability to regulate your emotions, and skills to understand and negotiate social relationships. That's what makes a great student. However, the coping mechanisms for trauma are withdrawal, I don't engage, I don't talk. I just sit there with the pencil in my hand, staring. Or hypervigilance, which is often diagnosed as ADHD. You're hypervigilant, you're on a swivel all the time, all the time. You're hypervigilant, because something's going on at home, something's going on in the hood, something's going on. So obviously one of the first ways to engage all of this is for us to be trained on the latest science and literature. Such an approach maximizes our chances to move beyond trauma responsive. We'll get to this. Recent data reveals that almost 650,000 children are adjudicated by the courts in this country. Of those, 22% will be sent to some form of placement, and of those, almost 80% of the placements will be locked facilities. So while the use of incarceration has deep historical roots, its current overuse is made easier because its utility is imposed mostly on young people of color from neighborhoods of concentrated poverty. The overrepresentation of youth of color in the juvenile justice system has drawn national and local attention since the 80s, and hundreds and thousands, if not millions, of federal, state, and private dollars have been dedicated to addressing this issue. Despite this attention, the overrepresentation of young people of color at every stage continues. Although the juvenile crime rate is at one of its lowest points in history, and progress has been made in reducing overall detention rates, as Fernando so eloquently stated, youth of color continue to be disproportionately arrested, referred to juvenile court, prosecuted, detained, and sentenced to secure confinement compared to their white peers. Now, one of the nation's architects, John Adams, a very interesting fellow, whom I read about a lot, remarked, this is one of my favorite quotes from John Adams, "Power always thinks it has a great soul." Power always thinks it has a great soul. In many communities of color, folks can think of justice systems as coercive since they reflect what is perceived to be the punitive and retributive power of the state. However, I beg to differ with that analysis. I believe that justice, in order to be sustained, requires not coercion, but consensus. In fact, the entire justice apparatus requires a grand bargain between those that govern and those that us that are governed. And essentially the bargain states this: we believe justice will be applied reasonably, fairly, and thereby working in our interests, and in turn, what we get for that is we will respect you and your apparatus. However, this bargain is breached if a significant segment of the community and the population believes that the justice system is unfair, biased, and doesn't serve their interest. In essence, they opt out of the bargain. And our most recent example of that, Ferguson, Missouri. You can see the breach on the streets. And more recently, in another context, the demonstrations in Hong Kong. There's a breach. We are not signing up for this contract. Coercion alone for justice professionals will never get the job done. There has to be consensus with the community. Has to be. So you are the key foot soldiers that make local objective decision makings possible. While it is clear that every child that is in conflict with the law may present a unique situation, there is also no doubt that sanctions should be similar for similar behaviors. We know from data that young people of color pay a higher penalty for similar behaviors than their white counterparts do. This study I'm going to commend to you, I don't know if you can see it, It was in the American Journal of Personality and Social Psychology, studied by UCLA. Stunning to me. Google it. It's called The Essence of Innocence. What this study found, and this is a group that works with police to train them and work with law enforcement. This is who law enforcement hires to work with them to be more community engaged. What this study found is when you had black, Latino, and white kids of the same age, and they showed them to police officers, a 7-year-old black kid was seen as 11 or 12. A 7-year-old white kid was seen as 5. And a 17-year-old Latino kid was seen as 10. Now, how is it that we could both, all of us be 7, and some of us seem to be older because at 7, you may not be able to go to juvenile hall, but at 11, you can. And not only that, they were seen as more culpable. This notion that, you know what, you may be okay sitting in this room, you may be okay when you walk out of here, but if I follow you long enough, you're gonna commit a crime, because that's what y'all do. This notion. This is structural. This is structural. These police officers aren't individually racist. They looked at a kid, they said, what age do you think it is? This is what they thought. This is a deeper problem than individuals. This is how structural racism lives in America. And in order for us to engage this, we must have an extra muscle to go deeper to look at it. Who has heard of or read this study? Breaking Schools Rules. Okay. We got the same 5 people in the back that have read everything. Breaking Schools Rules is the most comprehensive study, 6 million school and youth records from the Council of State Governments. Right down the middle, bipartisan, requested by both Republicans and Democrats. In Texas, because in Texas, kids get a universal identifier so you can follow them all the way through. Longitudinally, in ways that we never can in California. We'll never be able to do this in California at this level. And when they controlled for everything, they were shocked. This thing has moved policy. This thing, I know educators hate the word school to prison, because if you talk to classroom teachers, they go, I ain't at the beginning of no pipeline. I don't know what you're talking about. I'm just getting the disruptive kids out of my classroom. It's the principal that suspends them, not me. When they controlled for everything, most discipline was won outside the disciplinary code into those discretionary areas. And 2, when they controlled for everything, the only disparity that they could find in why kids of color got more severely disciplined was race and ethnicity. They tried to look for everything else. Very comprehensive study. I gave you the front of what it looks like. Google it. If you're in justice or in education, you need to read this study. And if you don't want to read the whole study, they got an executive summary, because that's what we all read. Some of us get paid to read, so we read the whole damn thing. If you're getting paid to read, just read the 2-page executive summary. I said, yes, I read that study. It was very interesting. Told me what I already know. So anyway, Breaking School Rules, I can't recommend it enough. And the Council of State Government is following up this study, and in November, next month, or December, you will hear on your local news about their follow-up study is coming out. Because they then went to investigate why race and ethnicity was such a potent thing in these schools. So while it may seem overwhelming, it need not be. As you know better than most, there is so much we now know. The technologies and innovations are there. In justice, they are objective decision making, day and evening reporting centers, two-tiered warrant systems, court notification systems, probation violation grids, on and on and on, things you can do in the justice sector. In the education sector, I want to introduce to you some slides that you may know, you may not know, that people are trying to do for classroom teachers, raise suspensions and expulsions. First, please see discipline as an integral part of the pedagogy. That discipline should not be something that's meted out separately from the rest of the person or the rest of the unit that's your classroom. Discipline is an integral part of your family. You don't have a discipline pedagogy in your house. You deal with it as it comes up. You respond based upon the behaviors. So that's the first thing. And what we want to do if you do that is we resolve and educate. We don't deport and discipline. We resolve matters and educate them. Now, some people said this sounds like pie in the sky. And I'm going to say to you, it's not pie in the sky. It's happening every day in this country. It's happening right now in this county. And you know where it's happening? At Santa Cruz Country Day School, where the tuition is $45,000 a year. They resolve and educate. They don't deport and discipline. Because when I pay you my $45,000, I'm paying for tolerance. So you call me. Don't call the police. That's what my check's gonna give you. At the public institutions, we get zero tolerance. So we know what resolve and educate looks like because it's happening every day. And it doesn't have to be the country day schools. It could be the parochial school with Sister Ann Margaret that grabs you by the pigtail and says, what the hell are you? Preventing discipline disparities, make relationships. Make it a part of academic rigor. Problem solve, engage. Have activities with the young people that are get to know you activities. So let me just give some examples. I'm not a classroom teacher, not gonna try to tell you how to do your business. But this is Walla Walla, Washington, currently called Lincoln High School. Now when the principal went to Lincoln High School, it had another name. And he said, this school is so bad, it's so funky, we're gonna start anew and we're gonna have a new name. And I don't care what the name is, but it's gonna be new. So that we don't associate what used to happen at this school with what's gonna happen now. So they named it Lincoln High. That was the new name. And his philosophy, the old philosophy was discipline with dignity. And what they found is that punishing misbehaviors, especially those with kids that had three or four more trauma incidents, and if you have free and reduced lunch programs, you really need to know what those kids are going through. He says it doesn't work with a traumatized kid. What we were doing isn't working. They'll just withdraw further or they'll just get more hyper. It's like, how can Johnny get more hyper? You wanna know? Ask Fernando, lock his ass up. You'll see how much more hyper they can get. It's like, Jesus, kid. So his philosophy was simple. Now I know a lot of people are gonna laugh and go, that's what his philosophy was. It's the same philosophy employed at the Country Day School for $45,000. Instead of saying, this is you, you just ask, what's going on? What's happening to you? What's going on in your life? Why are you acting this way? When I went to public school, we didn't have SROs. We had 2,000 teenagers. Can you imagine a place with 2,000 teenagers? Oh my God. After algebra and geometry class, ring, the bell rings, and it's chaos. Now you can ask them, walk in line, walk quietly, walk in line. It's developmentally not there. They're gonna burst out and explode. So if you don't let them explode in school, soon as the school bell rings, what happens to teenagers? The ba-yo-yo-yoing. It's a term. It's a boyoyoyoing. I know it doesn't mean anything, but it's the boyoyoyoing. And what is the boyoyoyoing? It's what can we do stupid together in the next half hour? Because we sat through school, they wouldn't let us talk. They wouldn't let us eat good. They made us eat apples. Don't give us no grease. We have to walk in silence. We can't touch nobody. So school is out. The boyoyoyoing takes over. Hey, why don't we run out in the street and avoid buses? That sounds like fun. Dare you to do it. Hey, why don't you get a tattoo with your eyes closed and be surprised? If we poll the 15-year-olds, y'all could come up with stupid stuff. Because that's what 15 is. So when we got in the fight in our class, when there was a fight in the halls, it was a fight. You got 2,000 15-year-olds. And ooh, don't let it be a girl fight. Girl fight! It's like, where? Get some hair pulling, you know. It was considered normal. The school didn't flip out. The school didn't trip out. The football coach and the basketball coach and the female tennis coach would pull the kids apart and say, what are you fighting for? And it would be the 15-year-old reason.
He's Kobe, I'm LeBron.
Yeah, two people who really are going to give you any of their money, right?
He said my girlfriend was ugly. I said his mama had warts.
I mean, we could just go on and on. Because when you're 15, you ain't invented enough sophisticated reasons to fight. You don't know enough.
He lives north. I live south.
Anything. So he just said, how do we deal with this? And you can see the suspensions dramatically increased in the course of a year. So you might look for this Walla Walla experience. Robert Redford's son has been filming there for a year and a half. They're editing the movie now. I've seen clips from it. And they're going to try to sell it to HBO or some documentary. I'm sure you can look for it. It's going to be called Lincoln High or something like that. And he's documenting what happened at Lincoln High. Garfield High. I want to talk about this. Who's heard about the Garfield High experience? Okay, same two people in the back, good. So here's what they did at Garfield. Garfield is like 99.99999 bagillion Latino in East LA. I think they got a couple brothers, couple Asians, you know, 3-4 Filipinos running around. But it's basically 100%, right? And so the new principal comes in. Garfield's a dropout factory. It's been a long time since Jaime Escalante was doing his teaching there, and they were going to national things. Garfield's dropout factory. So the new principal comes in, and he says, looking at suspensions and expulsions, and what we know in California, the number one reason for suspensions and expulsions is willful defiance, and 70% of kids of color are suspended and expelled for willful defiance. Now, fast forward, legislator in LA, representing Latinos, puts in legislation to get rid of willful defiance. It passes the legislature last year. The teachers union says, if you get rid of willful defiance, we will not be able to control our classrooms. Governor Brown said, okay, vetoed the legislation. After the veto of the legislation, the LA Unified School District, due to a lot of organizing and a lot of work in communities with parents and other people, said, well, we'll get rid of willful defiance as a school district on our own, the second largest school district in the country. So we don't know what the data is yet, but LA got rid of willful defiance. This year again, the legislator brought the thing up to the state of California. The legislation passed again, and this year Governor Brown signed it. So there's no more willful defiance statewide in California. Query to see if the schools turn into violent facts. So the data is not out, but we do know that that's not happening. But while all this was going on, and before it was going on, Garfield said, I don't care what they're doing, our school we care about. So what did they do? One, they told people 2 years in advance, in 2 years, people, you will not be able to use suspensions and expulsions as a tool. So we're getting you ready. So what did they do? They organized parents and parent councils. They began to give the teachers tools. Okay, y'all, come D-Day, September 1, 20 whatever, you're not gonna be able to use this, so you better go to this training. And we get the parents and the communities together. Parents begin to walk the halls. There's a parents' council. We do 2 years of prep. We don't just throw it out there as a memo and say, go fish. We prepare the entire institution that we're about to change. And they came up with a computer-based system called COST. Now, I don't have COST to hand out to you, but you can find it online. And basically, this is what they wanted the teachers to do as alternatives to suspension. So before, you referred to the dean and you suspended. After, the teachers have interventions that they use, the counselors have interventions, they brought the counselors back, they said we can't live without them. The dean looks at the attendance grades and whatever helps determine a reason, and the response is education because it is not suspension. And what is the data showing us at Garfield as a result? Suspensions fell by 100%, of course, because they didn't allow them. The API scores increased 20% in 5 years. As you can see, in 2008, when they were a dropout factory, to 2013. And the graduation rates are 8 points better, 3 points better there, better than the average, and 8 points better than the rest of LAUSD. That's the Garfield experiment. So I just want to say some other things. If you're a classroom teacher and you don't have your principal's support or you don't have the administration support, there are things you can do free of charge. David Lynch, anybody heard of David Lynch now that we're in an old movie house? Right, David Lynch makes them weird movies where people having sex, breathing oxygen and stuff. It's just weird movies. Well, old David has a foundation. And his foundation, the David Lynch Foundation, you should look it up if you want, has taken mindfulness to institutions. Some of you have heard about yoga in jail and detention. His thing is that we're going to do transcendental meditation. So David Lynch's particular thing is TM. Well, everybody ain't down with transcendental meditation. Some people are like, I don't even know how to say the words. I don't know what to think internally. I can't do all that. But what they have adopted is what we're calling mindfulness. And they piloted this mindfulness 2 minutes at the beginning of the class, 2 minutes at the end of the class of just silence. Just sit, think your own thoughts. Let's try to come to some peacefulness in the DC public schools. That's where they piloted it. Because they didn't think, they said if it works there, it'll work anywhere. And stunningly, the principals who were like, I don't know what this weird stuff is, but I told them, hey, for these people, try anything to keep these kids quiet. They go, oh my God, it worked. So maybe you want to think about creating some mindfulness in your classroom. Enhance predictability so that when I walk in your class, I know exactly what's going to happen. Exactly what's going to happen. How many of you are just like totally afraid of going to the dentist? My sister's one of them. Okay. A lot of y'all strong. Y'all like, I go to the dentist. Ain't nothing to me. Right? My sister is just phobic. She's phobic about the dentist and flying. She walks in the office. She's like, oh, I can't do it. Pull all my teeth. I'll just take dentures. Now, for those people that are afraid, or how many people have ever gone downhill skiing? And you're like, holy smoly, I don't know how to do this. What helps you is somebody going, you can do this. It's not no big deal. You see this hill? If you fall down, it ain't like, but like this, you can't hurt yourself. You're only going a half a mile every 80 years. So I'm going to walk you through it. It's predictability. So the dentist will say, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. Raise your hand if it hurts. So that you can then begin to not be in fear. If the dentist just says, sit down and I'll go to work, you could come up with anything in your head. So what we want to do is enhance predictability and IEPs for children and get to know you activities. Think about it. Have morning circles or check-ins real quick. Have students write their autobiographies. Talk about themselves. That you want relationships with these students, because when you have that, things go well. So what we need to gain traction and move ahead is political will, leadership, and courage. The structures are in place, and we only need to turn motion into movement. Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes commented that every idea is an incitement. It offers itself for belief, and if believed, it is acted on, unless failure of energy stifles the movement at its birth. I know that we will not be subject to a failure of energy which stifles the ideas in this room from our ability to address equitable and fair administration. We all go to work every day and do what we can to have an orientation of the spirit, to use our gifts to seek justice for proven risk youth and to educate young minds. We must always use our abilities and authority to articulate the humanity in young people that are being dispossessed simply because of who they are. Many of you sitting in this room know exactly what I'm talking about. When you positively impact youth and families, you can see the appreciation in their eyes. There is power that is unleashed, and I hope you never stop trying to find it. This requires a civil society to see itself as a champion of human potential, whose mission is to shape minds, touch souls, and motivate bodies. Vaclav Havel told us, hope is not optimism over pessimism, but hope is rather an orientation of the spirit. We must use humanity and equity as an orientation of the spirit to change the conversation regarding true public safety. No act is too small, no gesture too humble, as to be unrecognized by the least of these and all of these. Most beautifully stated in Micah, do justly, judge mercifully, and walk humbly. Justice demands that we be creative in order to change the balance of power regarding decisions about who will be the keeper and who will be the kept, who will be the servers and who will be served, and who will suffer abuse and who will be protected from harm. Thank you so much for your time and attention this morning. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. What time is it? Okay, we got 5 minutes for some questions. If people have it, you can come up, and we're going to give you your break in about 5 minutes. You can come up to the mics in the front if you have a question. If you're sick of me already, it's like, I ain't got to ask him nothing. That's fine, too. Any questions? Thank you for that warm reception. Some of y'all actually like that. Yes.
Good morning.
Morning.
So you go around the country and deal with juvenile justice reform. I guess my question is, you talk about using data. Big data is huge, and people talk about predictive policing. Can you tell me a little bit about how you've seen, do you know much about predictive policing and how it's used around the country, and then it's tied to?
No, I don't know it as a term of art. I do know use of CompStat data to determine how to deploy police and where police are going to be deployed. And the way that we use data with law enforcement is we do it in the context of the juvenile hall to look at the data to see where most of the kids come from by zip code. And then we engage what are the top offenses that we have kids of color in for, and then we involve law enforcement to say, what would we do differently, if at all, about these, about your procedures to bring young people to us? So we would go to the precinct that serves that zip code and not deal with the whole department, but deal with the captain of that precinct to say, let's talk about who's here. So that's our approach.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Hi.
Hi, thank you.
I just want to thank you for all the information. And I think every time I come to something like this, I guess I always feel very lucky and very fortunate and privileged that I'm being exposed to this information.
Yeah.
I think it's our communities that are not getting this information.
And actually some of the workers in the systems aren't getting it either.
But I think especially when we have places like Watsonville, uh-huh. where we have a majority Spanish-speaking population,
uh-huh.
I know, I work with the parents there, I know if they had even a piece of this information, it would truly help them better manage what they're doing.
What they're doing.
I just feel like there needs to be some next steps in getting this information out into the communities that need to hear it with a very adequate, professional interpreter who can interpret the information. I just know the parents there would benefit tremendously.
Absolutely, you're correct. And let me just say, we are available to do that and work with you. Tracy Benson is here. That's why we have the Community Justice Network for Youth as part of the Burns Institute to deal with families and communities. We have 200 programs around the country. And so we work with parents, young people. And so if you are interested in having us come to Watsonville, and we are not going to organize it from the Bay Area, but if you can help get it together, just like these folks help get it together, I drove down here for free. I got a parking ticket. You know, we'll do that. We'll come to Watson and eat at one of your many pizza parlors that you have down there. And we would love to do it. So we talk to everybody. So that's not just talk. Tracy, raise your hand, Tracy. Tracy's right there, talk to her. Go on our website and you can find out more what we do. So we will take you up on that challenge. We love talking to people, especially if you feed us. Yes.
How you doing, James?
How are you?
Good, it's been a while. So my thing is that, you know, you're essentially talking about policy and systems change and, you know, changing culture. But why don't we ever talk about culture? My question specifically is, you know, to this county who's very progressive, is how does it address that structural implicit bias?
Correct.
Right?
Yes.
You know, I work in Monterey County, we're super conservative, and that's a battle.
Oy.
But being in Santa Cruz County, which considers so progressive, how do you get over that kind of nostalgia?
Correct. It takes, well, first you have to start with data to understand what is the culture that you're trying to engage. And then it's going to take, I think what's happening with this planning process, it's going to take being at the table, fighting, cajoling, talking about it, and continuing to try to change these cultures. But you're right, it is not easy. But you must be you can't walk away from the table. You have to be there, and we have to really come up with ideas to process this. Yes, thank you. Okay, you know what, y'all? Oh, okay, one more question, and then we're going to break, because I'm sick of me, so I know y'all sick of me.
I'm wondering, is there data, or is anybody looking at the connection between adults that get youth involved in crime? So like the adults that are involved in criminal lifestyles that are
correct.
Getting the youth to deal
correct.
With drugs, to be
yes.
part of the gangs, to
mm-hmm.
steal for the gangs,
mm-hmm.
or whatever.
Correct. Yes, there are studies on that, but those studies aren't going to tell you what to do to break that chain. Who is very powerful? There's a group that you may know about in Los Angeles called the Anti-Recidivism Coalition, strictly a formerly incarcerated young people who come out and they were identified while they were in. They come out and they tell other young people how to break that chain. You will have formerly incarcerated young people saying, my daddy was crazy when I went in. My daddy is still crazy. If I'm looking for love from my father in order to start acting right, I'll never act right, because he's just not right. So I have to find other people to love me. So when you hear that coming from somebody that's coming out, that resonates with people who are having the same issues with their dad or that their brother is banging. And you know, how do you break that up? You're talking about families. Family's important. So I believe you need the voices of people who come from that background. They don't want to listen to me, right? I didn't do time in the pen. I mean, I did time to do no harm, you know what I'm saying about that, but I didn't do that kind of time, right? And so we need people who can speak that language, and there are groups that are powerful, and I invite you to look at the Anti-Recidivism Coalition in Los Angeles. Check out their website. Okay, good people, I'm sure they're great questions, but more importantly, you want the break.
So please come back and join us at 11:30. We'll be starting the panel discussion and talking about how these issues show up locally and what we can do about it. Thanks. Thank you, James.
Thank you.
Do you want some of this?
He has bling.
I got some bling. You're on the end?
So please come back on in. We'll start in just a few seconds. I know the bathroom line is long. So it's my pleasure and honor to introduce our panel today. And like I was saying earlier in the day, it takes a village, and these are some of the members of the village that are doing a lot of things differently. And that with the saying we like to say, United Way of Santa Cruz County and a lot of our change work, is that it's not about necessarily doing different things. We're already doing lots of things. But sometimes it's just about doing things differently. And that's what impresses me about our panel today. They're also very committed to the work that we're doing here and the work that we talked about today. And each of them recognizes the fact that there's also a ways to go and that there's things that we could do to improve. So we thank you for being here, each one of you. So today, the discussion will be facilitated by Valerie Thompson, also honored to introduce her, the Probation Juvenile Division Director. She's back here. She'll say hello in a second. And then our panel starts with Kenya Edison, Director of Student Services for the Pajaro Valley Unified School District. We also have Eileen Brown, Director of Student Services for the Santa Cruz City Schools. Beverly Brooke is down there, the Commissioner for Santa Cruz County Juvenile Justice Delinquency Prevention Commission, and also a retired U.S. probation officer and chaplain at Juvenile Hall. We have George Zamora joining us, a lieutenant with the Watsonville Police Department. Joe Hernandez, an officer with the Santa Cruz Police Department. Aaron Nelson Serrano, program director at Alcance and Community Action Board. And Reina Ruiz, program director at Santa Cruz Barrios Unidos. Quite a panel. Thank you again, and I'll let Valerie get started. One reminder, you've got index cards. We would love for you to be writing as you hear questions that come up for you, things that you want to know more about, to write on those index cards, and we'll be collecting them through the aisles throughout. So just look for somebody with a green bucket, stick it in there, and we'll ask those near the end. All right, thanks.
I was so happy when James got up here and said, y'all. I thought, oh, somebody from the South. I turned to Yolanda and I said, where is he from? And she said, I don't know. I said, he has to be from the South. He said, y'all. Since I've been here, I always start whenever I talk with folks with, hey, y'all. So I'm really happy to be here, really happy to facilitate the conversation. Just to let you know a little bit of what we're going to do is we're going to sort of go down the line and give each of our panelists about 5 minutes to speak on a specific topic, and Megan is going to be somewhere out here sort of holding up her hand to cut us off and be our timekeeper. We hope that this will allow you to use your index cards to ask more questions, to give us more in-depth conversation. So we're going to start with Kenya, and she's going to talk about school discipline reform efforts.
All right. Hello, everyone. All right. I am a proud colleague and member of Pajaro Valley Unified School District in Watsonville, where we have 20,000 students, 33 schools, and awesome things going on. Over this past year, I've been in this position as Director of Student Services. I was coordinator prior to this for now going on 4 years, so I'm excited about it. In the last 3 years, we've really looked at our data, and I'm proud to say that we're down in expulsion 60% in 3 years. And thank you. And down in our suspensions, our suspension rate, we're down 39%. So I'll push that up to 40 and round up, so that's pretty good. I attribute that really to, and what James was talking about, is looking at the data. We can disagree with what I feel, because you feel differently than I do. We can't disagree with what the data says. The data says that students are being suspended and expelled differently based on if they're affluent background, the color of their skin, or if their parents are present and making noise on campus. When we take all of those things out, we should be disciplined based on behavior. So if a student is smoking marijuana at a South County school and smoking marijuana at a North County school, the discipline should be the same. And really not looking at discipline as an intervention. Suspension is a discipline. It does not intervene. It removes the student from campus, and sometimes necessary, if there's fights, if there's a huge brouhaha, the girls pulling hair, he talked about. Sometimes a day off campus and apart gives time to cool down, do an investigation, bring everyone back, and try and do a conflict resolution. So I'm not anti-suspension. But I am glad that we're looking at the data and my colleagues are being brave enough to break the status quo. Countering systems, questioning, looking at students, looking at with behavior in classes where students are always referred. And my mother used to always say this at my parent-teacher conferences, all your teachers can't be lying. So if students are being referred from the same classroom all the time, it's time to start looking at that environment in that classroom. And so I totally attribute all of the change. I know in the newspaper they kept quoting my name, and I'm a behind the scenes type person. But in the article, all of the accolades should have been to my colleagues at the sites, because I just bring the data and start the discussion and then pose the questions. Would this student be disciplined this way if their family lawyer was sitting right next to them in the discipline conference? If they wouldn't, they need to be in school. We should treat every student as if they have an advocate sitting right next to them. Phyllis Katz is in the audience, and she advocates, so we're adversaries most times, but I respect her mission, because it is bringing a voice to families who usually don't have a voice. So our practices really are now being influenced by our data. We could say, oh, we don't suspend as much over here. We don't suspend for that. K came up. And just to clarify and correct, K we still have in California, unfortunately. It was rewritten. We can't suspend students K through third grade for K. We can't suspend for 4th through 12. But we can no longer expel for K. K is willful defiance or disrupted school activities. So that's awesome. Showing our sites that at our secondary level last year, the year before last, we had 690 suspensions that involved K. In 13-14, we had 262. That's awesome. 2 years before that, we had 982, round up, 1,000. The data told the story, not Kenya. I didn't go and say, I think you guys are doing suspending K too much. I say the data says that you have 900 suspensions for K, 800 of them are Latino students, 900 are male students. So the data tells that story. I don't have to go in with what I believe and how I feel. Now, my core belief, if you know me, if you've ever received an email from me, is that success is the only option for every kid. That's the signature on my email. Any email that I send out will reflect that I expect success for every student. The expectation is that students will not only show up to school, but they'll be successful while they're there. So anything that we do on our campuses should reflect that belief. We can't teach a kid who isn't in school. Teaching is not just reading, writing, and arithmetic. It's also teaching appropriate behaviors. It's using teachable moments. Most of the K violations are teachable moments. Students stood up, he screamed, ran across the class, thumped someone in the head, disrupted the class. But if you use it as a teachable moment, kids come back different. You're sending the behavior home with a suspension and expecting that it's just gonna disappear when they return back to school. No. We have to teach appropriate behaviors to replace inappropriate behaviors, and that happens in the school setting. I totally tip my hat to all of our colleagues. We have some of our parent educators here, and I'm so thankful to them with Teresa and Ruby, because that is the other part of the puzzle that was missing. We're telling parents, we're handling school, you handle home, and in the middle, kids will figure it out. Now we're saying, no, we're a team handling your child, and we're gonna agree on your child's success. So come on in, let's work together. And we have a parent series that we're doing, and we have done for years, actually, but really trying to centralize it and uniform it for parents that of our frequent flyers, or our BAs, I call them, I love them to death, our badass kids. And really trying to say success is really the only option, and it's the only option for every kid. And success looks different for everybody, and that's okay. But we're gonna make sure that success is the only option.
Thank you, Kenya. Eileen is going to continue this theme and talk to us a little bit about student success.
Thank you. And I'm here representing Santa Cruz City Schools. And the work that we do is we're working on every level. So we're working in our leadership teams, our administration, our superintendent, our teachers, our students, and our parents, and our other staff members. We have looked at our data over several years, very similar to what Kenya described, really going back to that data, looking at how are we doing in our discipline? How are we doing in our referrals for special education services? How are we doing in our students completing college prep classes as opposed to a non-college prep track? And once we started really disaggregating that data, we found that we had lots of challenges in our school district. And as Kenya said, it just became so apparent when you put the data up there. And I'm just gonna read you just one of our statistics and the changes that we've made and talk about what we've been working on. And I loved what Megan said, it's an ongoing process. We still have plenty of challenges and I feel like we're just getting started and we're ready to move. So just in looking at our college prep students, because one thing we looked at was really looking at our discipline data as really a progress monitoring of how we're doing school-wide. How's our culture? How's our climate at our schools? Do students want to be there? Are they being included? Are we really an inclusive group? And I loved what the questioner used that word nostalgic. I hadn't thought of that before, but many people are nostalgic for how things used to be. And we're getting really clear that this is how it is now. And our whole system has to adjust to the population of students and the community that we live in now, not the community we might have worked in when we started our careers 25 years ago. So we looked at our students completing our college prep requirements, which is really the highest standard that you can have in our K-12 system. You can complete diploma requirements, but completing college prep is a whole nother level. So in 2010, when we first looked, we had 17% of our Latino students completing the college prep requirements. Last year, we had 33% completing those requirements. Our African American students, we had 35% completing those requirements, and last year, we were at 58%. And our students with disabilities, which is often a group of students who aren't always disaggregated out, we had 24% completing college prep requirements, and last year, we had 35%. Our English learner students, we had 0% in 2010. And last year we had 8% completing the full college prep requirements. So how did we do that? First of all, I think it starts with leadership. We said this is going to be the norm. So all 9th and 10th grade students are going to be registered into the college prep curriculum. They can no longer come into 9th grade and take non-college prep classes. So that was a big adjustment for our staff. Started with our counseling team. And for them to really start those conversations with students of, you can do it. We're putting you in this class. No, you can't take non-college prep science. You can't take that easier class. You're going to be in the college prep science. Then it took working with our staff, our teaching staff. You have the ability to reach every student. These are the tools. Here's how to differentiate your instruction. Here's how to really support students. We read the research. We looked at what other schools were doing. We brought in trauma-informed practices, so our staff is being trained in that. We really looked at what does it take to really move this whole system forward? How do we really change the culture? And as you know, having people shift their mindset is really difficult. And we just keep at it. We just keep at it. It's really, it's a moral, ethical imperative in our district that we have to keep doing this work. And we're really not going to any longer have the conversation about, well, you know, the homes I come from, and you know, they're poor, and you know, they just moved here, and you know, they live in a bad neighborhood, it's hard for them to get to school. That there are many things that we don't have a lot of control over in our school system, but we do have control over 6 hours a day on our campus. And we have to put everything we can into that, and there are no excuses anymore. There's no reason why every student can't achieve in those classes. And I think as a result of that culture and climate work we're doing, we really have seen a tremendous drop in our discipline. So for example, in our elementary school, when we started this work in 2009, we had 1,000 referrals for discipline to the principal's office. Last year we had 39. So it's this huge school overhaul. We don't need to send kids to the office because they're misbehaving. They need to be in school learning. Every time they leave the classroom, they're missing instructional time. They need to be in here and they need to be learning. We can handle this stuff. We can handle kids acting out. We can handle kids who might behave differently than we behaved when we were kids. We can broaden what the range of acceptable behavior is and keep those kids in school. So we want to keep looking at that. We just keep disaggregating that data. We keep looking at how we're doing, and we just keep pushing forward. And as teachers start seeing the success, more get on board. So I think once you start seeing a little success, like that kind of data, it's like, oh, we can do it. Let's just keep working hard at it. So it just, it keeps on growing that way.
Thank you. Joe Hernandez with the Santa Cruz Police Department is going to talk to us about community law enforcement trust and positive relations. I can say we know a lot about that because they partner with us in juvenile probation, and it's an extremely important relationship that bears fruit. When kids can trust law enforcement, you really are one step ahead of the curve in anything that you're trying to do in the community. So if you'll talk to us a little bit about that.
I got to start off by saying I appreciate them putting the microphone up like this. So I physically have to put it down in front of you guys. They thought someone taller was coming to my place, I suppose. But community involvement, I think it's important with the police department and what it is that we do. I think the collaborations that we're involved with, not just with the probation department, but also looking at the various agencies and organizations throughout the Santa Cruz area, also our partnerships with the schools. We're part of BASTA, which is the Broad-Based Apprehension, Suppression, Treatment, and Alternatives in North County. We work very closely with Santa Cruz City School District. We work very closely with the County Office of Education. Probation has always been a close partner of ours as well. And I think that what we're doing there is making a huge difference in the lives of some of these kids. It's looking at how we can assist them, looking at some of the wraparound models that probation already had and how we can bring that over to BASTA and how we can further assist the kids, especially those kids that haven't gotten to the probation system where they're getting that service. How do we then start to give them those services there? Above that, not just looking at what we're doing in collaboration with other organizations or agencies, but how we're reaching out to our communities. And as a police department in Santa Cruz, what we do is we provide a Citizens Police Academy. And that's a 10-week program where we give the community members an opportunity to see how the Santa Cruz Police Department works. It's to give them an understanding of what we do on a day-to-day basis, and also how we investigate crimes and things of that sort, and why things take so long. We also end that with an assistant district attorney and judge to come in and speak about what their components are. And I think it helps give an understanding of why things take so long in the system. We do that in both English and Spanish. I think it's important, especially with our Latin population in Santa Cruz, for them to have an understanding of what it is that we're doing. And what's nice about our Citizens Police Academy is that we have a different officer come in and teach each different subject. And when we do it in Spanish, it's completely done in Spanish. There is no translation. It's Spanish-speaking officers. So they get to meet the officers. They get to know who they are. And it's actually benefited us when we do investigations, because people feel like they have that rapport. They have that relationship. They know the officers. They can talk to them. It's not just some random person coming to my door saying, hey, what did you see? It's, hey, I remember you. How have things been since the class? And this is what I saw. So it's created an opportunity for us to have more of a dialogue with our community members. Sorry, I'm not used to being under spotlights here. I feel like I'm a sports star or something. But in addition to that, we also do work with our youth. We have our Teen Public Safety Academy, which is a week-long program that's 40 hours, and it's for those that have an interest in law enforcement or the fire service. And it's to get some interest in our youth for them to understand. To go through the background, it's really difficult. And what happens a lot of times is our youth make mistakes. They make bad decisions. So because they make those decisions, it knocks them out of the background process. And what we're trying to do is give them that understanding of what it is that they need to do and what kind of decisions they need to make if they want to come into this line of this field. We also have our PRIDE program, which stands for Personally Responsible Individual Development and Ethics. And that's to help our at-risk youth, kids that are making bad decisions, to help them make better decisions. Mr. Bell said, there's not one program that's going to fix every kid, and that's true. I don't stand here today and pretend that the PRIDE program is going to fix the kids, but I will tell you that we have had some success, that some of the kids that have come through our program are doing well, and that I just got the 1 minute warning. Thanks for being subtle, Sarah. And what I really like about the program, though, is we partner them up with a mentor, and I think having someone who is positive in their life, that has given them positive guidance, really makes a difference in the kids' lives. And I believe Mr. Bell said this earlier, where he said, you just need someone there who's telling them, hey, my dad was crazy going into jail, my dad is still crazy now, but find someone who's gonna love you out there. And I think that's what's important. Everyone wants to feel like they're a part of something, so it's important that we all get engaged and that we help out our youth.
Thank you. I just want to say before Lieutenant Zamora shared some words with us that we were talking about a case this week in juvenile probation, and we thought the one key that we needed in order for this youth to be successful was to reconnect him with his partner from law enforcement who was working with him as a mentor, because that's when this youth did the best. I think that sort of highlights relationships and collaboration. Probation cannot do it all, the schools can't do it all, or at least not alone. So when we work together and we work to benefit kids, we bear fruit. Lieutenant Zamora?
Hi.
Hey.
Everybody can just call me Jorge. You don't gotta do the whole lieutenant thing. That's cool. I'm gonna time myself here. So as far as Watsonville PD and what we're doing at our agency, I think we're really starting to push our officers to their edge state, you know, pushing them to their edge so that they're doing things that they may have not been comfortable doing maybe 20 years ago. That includes things like working with groups, community groups that in the past we may have just kind of turned away from. And I think that's really, really positive. One of the things that we do is we select certain officers that grew up in the community that have maybe worked in the fields, speak the language very well, and then we have partnered with the school district. I saw Ruby, or heard Ruby earlier around here someplace, Ruby Vasquez and Joanne Borboya, who's really have helped us connect with the families that probably fear us the most. And if when you look at an officer, I don't care who you are, but if you're driving and you see, you see the cops behind you, you're not thinking, oh my God, there's a cop, thank God. You're thinking, damn, right? Now you're thinking that. Imagine what the undocumented farm worker is thinking. So for our officers, we really try to push them to, and we're very deliberate in selecting these officers to go out and really engage in a conversation, not only a training, but engage in a conversation with people to get to know their values. Because if you haven't read Brian Hall's book on value shift, values really determine a person's behavior. And I think it's very important to note that, because once we, as officers, know what some of these unheard voices value in the community, then we are better able to serve them. These workshops take the officer from the uniform and the patrol car and the motorcycle into a classroom when they're actually facilitating and working with the parents to actually teach them something. And at the end of these workshops, we're taking pictures with people, we're hugging people, you know. People are telling me that they're my aunt, my uncles. And it's just a really positive experience. And we bring different agencies to help us out with that. In the past, the Peace and Unity March in Watsonville is coming soon in November. I encourage everybody to show up. Oh, crap. Really?
Sorry.
Really? Someone's getting a ticket today. Okay, I think it's November 1st. The flyers are out front. Someone's going to pray for me. So we've gone from, you know, years past to really just paying officers overtime to monitor the march. This year we're having officers participate in the march, and they're volunteering their time, which I think is huge. You know, I think it's huge, and I got to give a shout out to the Peace and Unity March Coalition, who actually reached out to us and said, we want you to be a part of this. And I thought, this is what I was waiting for. Because the police culture is changing, and Eileen talked about where we are now, and I think we are not, the police culture is not where it was before when I started, and I am not the same officer that I was 20 years ago. I'm not. And I'm slowly learning that doing police work now doesn't necessarily have to involve the handcuffs. And I think that's really powerful to model, because although it is necessary at times to do enforcement and make arrests, we have to do it with a certain level of understanding and compassion and human dignity, and really see the person for who they are, not for who they appear to be. And I think that really connects us, or lets us, or allows us to see our common humanity, if you will. So I think that's really going to be it for me. Unless anybody's got some donuts, because I do love donuts, by the way. So I just throw that out there. So if you got a ticket, you got a donut, come see me. All right, I'll hook you up, man. Thank you.
And Beverly Brooke, our commissioner with the Juvenile Justice Delinquency Prevention Commission. She is always in our juvenile hall, being a supporter, being an advocate. She's going to talk to us about direct files.
So my awareness and concern regarding racial disparity in the correctional system began during my field education studies while attending seminary. Following my graduation, I returned home and soon began serving as the chaplain at the Juvenile Detention Center in Santa Cruz County. During this time, I was appointed as a commissioner on the Juvenile Justice Delinquency Prevention Commission, which focuses on the broader issues of juvenile justice and delinquency prevention in our county. And I'm reading off my notes because I'm a preacher, and I'd go way over 5 minutes if you let me, so I'm just gonna stick to script. Through my work as chaplain, I became aware of what appeared to be a racial disparity of the youth who were direct filed. To be candid, I was not exactly clear on what constituted a direct file case, nor why and how this legal process was used. I began to inform myself on what constitutes a direct file case, what is the ethnic makeup of the county, and the youth charged as direct file. Currently, the commission has a subcommittee preparing a report for the Board of Supervisors on direct file cases. But in the interest of time, I will briefly summarize what constitutes a direct file case. In 2000, California voters passed Proposition 21, which basically overturned the legal process that required juvenile court judges to approve transferring a youth offender's case into the adult system prior to trial. Before the passing of Proposition 21, the use of a fitness hearing would be utilized. In these hearings, the juvenile court could take into consideration the age of the youth, the sophistication of the offense, the potential for rehabilitation, and mitigating circumstances. In the hearing, the court ruled whether the youth was amenable or not unfit for juvenile court. Proposition 21 allowed the district attorney to bypass the fitness hearing process and send the matter directly to adult court for trial, hence the term direct file. In the past 10 years in Santa Cruz County, there has only been one fitness hearing, and that was this year for a white young man. It also expanded the number of offenses that require direct transfer to adult court under the Welfare and Institutions Code 602B, called mandatory transfers. Direct files include murder, attempted murder, robbery, assault with a deadly weapon, shooting at an occupied dwelling or vehicle, and unlawful carrying or possession of a weapon, all which carry potential enhancements for being gang-related. Once in adult court, youth offenders face sentences to full adult criminal terms, including life imprisonment. The W. Hayward Burns Institute reported in 2012 that between 2006 and 2011, 43 youth in Santa Cruz County were direct filed. Of these, 38, or 88%, were Latino. 35 out of the 43 offenses were classified gang-related. As to what classifies or constitutes gang-related, everyone has a differing opinion as to that classification. The factors affecting racial disparity in direct file cases, if it does exist, are multifaceted and are not easily defined or evaluated. However, in the interest of true juvenile justice, okay, this is the good part though, Sarah. However, in the interest of true juvenile justice, as a community, we owe it to the youth to seek the answers. We cannot allow our youth to be warehoused under the guise of safety or expediency.
Thank you. So next, Erin Nelson Serrano is going to talk to us about youth employment, and she has a really unique view, being that she was formerly with probation and now as the program director for El Alcance and the Community Action Board. She really has a unique view of what our kids' needs are, having served them in probation and now on the community side. So thank you.
Thank you. Unlike Jorge, I would like you to call me Lieutenant.
Nice.
We'll pray and, for you.
Thank you. I was very pleased at the opportunity to have my staff at Alcance come and hear, and other co-workers from the Community Action Board come and hear James Bell today, because I think that he is an inspiration, and he is able to articulate something that we often sense and can't really find our own voice about that. The Community Action Board is Santa Cruz's designated anti-poverty organization, and within that, Alcance does employment and leadership development for youth and adults. Our population, our client base, is disparately represented because these are folks who live in poverty. And also because of the referral system that we've set up with the justice system and schools and other community-based organizations, that when kids are in trouble, they refer them to us for mentorship and employment services. We know that in Santa Cruz County, Latino youth under the age of 18 are 3 times more likely to live under the 100% of federal poverty than their white counterparts. Latino youth are 3 times more likely to live in poverty. So other people could, you know, many of you could come up here and talk about how to work with youth. I'm not an expert compared to the rest of you in that respect, but I will talk to you about what our values are in Alcance about doing employment work. We have to value youth. That is part of our mission at Alcance, and by the way, we were formerly CRP, if people know CRP. But part of our mission says that we will honor and serve those who are under-resourced, at risk, and involved in the justice system, so that it is part of our mission, our drive, to serve people and to honor them, those who are living in poverty, and those who are disparately represented as racial and ethnic minorities, or majority minorities, as James says. We make sure that the people who we work with who have multiple barriers to employment, that we display an appreciation for youth culture. And part of the value of youth culture is also to value racial and ethnic diversity, and to understand youth development, and also to be strength-based. And that is how we are able to build rapport with our clients, with youth. And we make sure that we meet them where they're at. So that means that we'll go to New School, where the Sereno or Southside affiliated students who attend school and who can't get to our office safely, that they also have access to our services. We make a point to network with County Office of Education and alternative schools to go on site to increase access for resources for those who don't have resources within their home or within a more traditional school environment. And I do want to say that there are so many partners through alternative ed and through ROP and through the conventional school system who are building really healthy employment programs. And those benefit all kids, but most especially those the lowest hanging fruit. So those kids who are able to take advantage of those services. The kids who we work with may have difficulty accessing those services. They may have difficulty understanding how you meet the expectations of working in a job. So we continue to hold the standard, or what the standard is. But when that kid can't meet the standard, we never close the door. So I worked with a young man who's now 27, and I'm happy to say that at age 27, he has been out of custody for the longest period of his life since he was 11. And he just reflected the value of doing the employment work. He was ordered to do community service hours and joined our work crews and hated it and was a butt. And but what he got eventually when he was able to mature enough is an appreciation for the respectful relationships and the value that he developed when he was part of that programming. And that's what you all do, is create a safe space for kids. And we need to hold the standard and the expectation, but we can never close the door. So this 27-year-old, he went through foster care. He was involved in the dependency system, the delinquency system, and then on to prison. And he finally gets that what the standard is, and he knows that the door is not going to close. I think what I want to say is I just want to identify a gap in the services that exist, that the services don't meet the need, and what we really need are employment services that are not necessarily outcome-based, because what we have right now are employment services where people qualify for entry into these services based on the fact that they're low income and part of an ethnic minority. However, they have to demonstrate the ability to benefit. And that doesn't mean, are the kids going to be better off because they participated in these services? What it means is, are they going to be successful in this program to meet outcomes so that we continue to receive funding? So you're basically, again, selecting in the low-hanging fruit. So we need to have a community value around youth employment. I would posit that what we should do, as a contractor with the county, we're required to pay a living wage. I would suggest that county contractors are also required to employ a percentage of youth. Now, I didn't make that up. I stole it from another jurisdiction, but it embeds the value of youth. And I'll tell you, the person that I would hire is somebody who's got a bunch of facial tattoos and somebody who's got a hairline, you know, a trigger for the temper, and who isn't going to do well in competitive employment. And that's the kind of person that you continue to hold the standard, but you never close the door. So thank you so much.
So Raina Ruiz, who's the program director for Santa Cruz Barrios Unidos, is going to talk to us about culturally based and relevant prevention and intervention programs. And of course, they are also a partner with us and in the community at large. So please share with us.
Thank you. That is a mouthful.
Yes.
I feel James did a great job. I can take a break now. Let's see. I think I should note that Santa Cruz Barrios Unidos has been or was a founding member of CJNY, or the Community Justice Network for Youth, and has been a part of that for over a decade. And our work really in terms of youth and community, we bear the brunt, I think, the communities that we work, you know, the families that we work with are the most impacted. And so the stakes are really high, I would say. And so as an organization, our work is really around the belief that our work around violence prevention is that there is power in healing and there's power in reconciliation. You know, we go where most people don't go. We were at a conference in LA, and Nana took me to the Maravilla Projects. And you wonder what that has to do with the work here locally, and it really is, you wanna know what the issues, the challenges are of those that are involved or most heavily involved in gangs. To know what not to do, or to bring those words of wisdom back to community, and you have to engage them. So, you know, in the work that we're doing, I think I just started about a year ago. I've known about Barrios Unidos for a really, really long time. They've been actually in the community since 1977, and Nana started out of the back, was it a 64 or a 67, right? Chevy, doing the work, the peace work. But I didn't realize until I came to BU the extent of our network, the extent of the dedication and the work that we do. You know, we're at Santa Cruz High School, working hard to keep the students in the classroom, in the school, tying them back to community. We're at Pajaro Valley High School, we bring the prison trailer. So whatever it takes is we build a prison cell, you know, so that people can, so that youth can relate, so that they can see in a different way, perhaps, and engage them. Teachers talk about scaffolding learning. We use art, culture, and spirituality in a way that that reaches young people in a way that matters. Let's see. I don't know. I have to say that today my brother is in court dealing with 225 to lives, and that when we talk about being in the peace movement, and when we talk about this work, these young people that we see are not just statistics. They are our families, they are our kids. We really must believe in healing and reconciliation. The work of culture and spirituality is important. I don't know if I'm the most articulate to talk about it. I have been working in the grassroots community for a long time. And I'm glad you talked about direct files, because I think these are young people, and we need to bring them back to community. The impacts that happen are not just to that young person, but to the entire community. And for example, we were at a supper club at PCS. We have a program, a Beach Putz Kids Club, and we're working with Pacific Collegiate School on study skills and college awareness, because we want kids to have what everybody else has, right? To excel in college. And I had a parent that said, you know, years ago, she was a student. She was born here in Santa Cruz. And yet her Spanish isn't really good. And I said, well, why is that? She said, well, I spent most of my years here at Santa Cruz in a special education classroom and didn't speak Spanish until I was in high school. And now I'm working with her children, and her children are in special education, and her children are one of her children is in fourth grade and doesn't know how to read. And so she's dealing with some of those same issues. And so the more the community gets together and talks about those issues, the more that you see how this plays out. And as advocates in community, I think it's, the role that BU has played, it's sort of like the Latina in the boardroom sometimes. The one voice in the classroom that is the advocate for those families and for those kids. And we need more of those voices, those teachers, those allies, the youth. Shout out to Youth City Council, Costa Noah, and Watsonville Youth City Council for being here today. Because we need those voices. And you even need to hear those voices of active gang members in here so that you can hear, or so that we can all work together, because that healthy tension that we're talking about is important. There is an imbalance, I believe that we just all need to work together. Thank you.
So we're gonna invite everyone who has the index cards to please write down any questions that you have, and they're gonna be passed up here to me, and I'm going to ask them in order, and anyone on the panel who wants to chime in, please do. We'll at least try to have one response per question so that we can move the conversation along, okay? So one of the first questions to the panel is, how are you addressing racial and ethnic disparities in your organization or field? What is it that you're doing that's maintaining a focus on that, and you're using either data or issues that have come up to drive your actions to get outcomes? Kenya?
I'll answer that, gladly. Am I gonna get a 1 minute mark on this one? Okay. Before I answer that question though, if I may pause, I don't want anyone to leave here today thinking that New School is a Sureño school. It's a school for all kids. I know that has been historically the belief within our community and kind of played out that way. And me and Aaron, we're closely together, so I'm an advocate for my kids and I'm an advocate for Pajaro Valley. So I don't want anyone to leave here thinking that New School is solely for Sureño kids, because it's not, it's for all kids. On that question, doing just what I spoke of earlier is just using the data to have those critical conversations. Change work is not for wimps. If you want to be liked, you probably shouldn't try and change the status quo. Change is difficult. It is, people resist it. You have to believe in your core that the work that you're doing is worth the effort that you're gonna put out. You also have to believe that you're gonna come up against people who don't agree with you, which is fine. So changing the system, my colleague Eileen, she shared awesome data. That's great. Like she said, it's not easy. It's holding an expectation for everyone. The data shows that we have expectations for kids because they get suspended, they get sent out of class, they get sent home. But having an expectation of the people who receive paychecks, right? With that check is an expectation. And the expectation is that we are going to help every child succeed. And if the data shows that our practices are not enforcing success for kids, then it's time to have those critical conversations with the data. Our expulsions and suspension data over 3 years, it wasn't because everyone said, oh yeah, that's right, you're good, let's do this. They said, this is how we've always done it. What are you talking about? And who are you? I'm originally from San Diego. I've been up here 4 years. I was an outsider moving in, but we all could agree as colleagues that kids not being in school meant they weren't learning. It also was that if they weren't in school, they also weren't learning appropriate behaviors. They also weren't probably plugged into positive people situations and environments. So first thing with impacting change when you're looking at the disparities is don't be afraid. Don't expect to be liked. Just share the data. And don't water the data down. Gotcha, Sarah. Don't water the data down because it would make for a lighter conversation. Mm-hmm. Tell it exactly how it is. I'm a mother of daughters, and I always tell them, yeah, it's not always what you say, but how you say it. So yell if you're delivering vinegar, serve it with a muffin. But serve it. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't water that down. You can't go into it and say, I'm going to advocate more for adults to have an easy day than I am for kids to succeed. Okay, and that's kind of what it is. Success is the only option. Go in there with that belief and then use your data to shift practices and policies. If you're in a position to influence change, have your Wheaties before you go to work. If you want something nice to be said about you, if you're having that critical conversation, say it to yourself before you get there. Because change is hard. It's difficult. All of us have to do things differently at some point in our life. But do we believe that our kids are worth it? Hell yes. Is it worth people not liking you for the moment? Hell yes. But we have to do it. We've had our chances through all of our education in schools where we either got knocked down or picked up or whatever the case is. But for our kids today, it's critical. The only positive thing they may hear come from you. And if the expectation is we just want you to show up, then the efforts that we put forth as adults would just be show up efforts. But if the expectation is we want you to show up and succeed, and we're gonna make sure that our policies and practices support that, and we're not gonna suspend more Latino males than we do any other ethnicity. If our population is 70% Hispanic, we're not gonna have 90% of our suspensions being Hispanics. That's a disparity. And I'm gonna be empowered to have that conversation with the people who are making those decisions. I'm done, you ain't even gotta get up.
Thank you, Kenya. So I'm gonna move on to ask another question. Although I know the whole panel sort of reflects working collectively with others, we have a question just to talk to us about what it looks like when you work collectively across fields or jurisdictions to address disparities. What does it look like or sound like to connect with each other, to come together and do the work? Anybody who wants to chime in?
I will, but I'll give them an opportunity to speak.
Okay.
I'd like to address that, if I may. Okay. It's interesting, having had the perspective of being a probation officer and working inside the system and then going out and being a community-based partner, it's challenging to maintain trust, I think. And so the efforts that we've gone through with the Youth Violence Prevention Task Force really demonstrate how we've developed relationships and come light years from where we've been, let's say, in the last decade. But these are relationships that need to be nurtured, and we have certainly so much more power together when we're looking at system change. But it is difficult to be a CBO, let's say, and be mindful of serving your clients, but then also maintaining credibility and integrity and transparency, let's say, with government or other partners.
Thank you. Certainly.
I'd like to respond. I think that we have a great model of working across jurisdictions right now with our Keeping Kids in School and Out of Court Task Force. So it's a group that's been brought together by Judge Morris, and it includes schools, law enforcement, many, many community partners, children's mental health, legal aid, the public defender's office, the district attorney's office. And I think it's a great model because we each bring some expertise to that, and none of us can solve these problems alone. And so if we can bring these groups together, so we have the students, but our main role is teaching. Our main role is not supporting mental health. We don't have the expertise to do that. Our main role is not working with the court system. We don't have the expertise to do that. We're not legal folks in schools. But when we can bring those groups together, then we can really lay the foundation for some structural changes, some interagency work, and then the actual supporting of individual student work. So I think that we are starting to do that. It is a data-driven group. We're looking at attendance data. We're looking at it disaggregated by ethnicity so that we can look at what's the structural issues that are going on in our systems, and then how do we start addressing those? I think the other piece of it, when we work across agencies that has been helpful, is we are all looking at, well, in schools we call it research-based practice. I think in probation they call it evidence-based practice. But we're all looking at the same thing. We're not going to do something if we don't know the data behind it. Does it work or not? And when we do something, we're looking at the data before and the data after. And if it's not working, we're refining and refining and refining so that we're not sort of just throwing darts and hoping something will work, but we're bringing all of our expertise together. And I think that that group has been working as a really great model of working across jurisdictions.
Thank you. So our next question from the audience is, how do we break down the silos and get results?
Eileen just said all the best things.
Yeah.
Having a uniform mm-hmm. effort countywide.
I think if I could just add to that too, is that it shouldn't just be at the top. You know, I work with a great staff in probation, and I sort of consider them ambassadors. They understand evidence-based practices. They understand the ills of overrepresentation in our juvenile hall. They are on committees in the community. I think that if we're all mindful in our various agencies or departments that we work for, of everybody being knowledgeable, being educated, being well-trained, and really walking the talk. You know, if you say you're going to do this, how is that evidenced by what you're doing and the results that you're getting? And I know that our staff is, you know, they're out in the community with the kids. Julia and the RAP team are taking them on cultural events. They are not just saying, oh, you did this, okay, now go and follow the rules of probation. They are engaging them in the community in a positive way. The probation officers are advocating for kids. They're going to school meetings. They are doing whatever they need to do to try to work with kids at any level of need. So I think that as we all, and again, in our capacities, do that and spread it throughout our staff, we'll have better outcomes. So our next question.
Can I just add something
sure.
on the direct file? I think one of the things that we need to do is to educate. I mean, I consider myself a very educated person in the criminal justice system, and I didn't know about direct file when I came back to Santa Cruz, and we voted for it. I mean, I don't think Santa Cruz County probably did, but the state of California did, and yeah. I've worked with folks that work in the prisons, and they weren't really aware of direct file and that we are taking these 14, 15, 16-year-old kids and giving them 25 to life sentences. So for me, it's going out there and just talking in public about direct files. This is what we're doing mm-hmm. as a community to these youth. And I just want to add, and I get these words from Michael Painter, who I'm not sure is still here, but he shared with me the other day that we have this tension of accountability and empathy. And I think sometimes what happens is when perhaps I talk, people will say, oh, well, you know, what do you expect, mm-hmm. you know? She just wants this. She doesn't want accountability. And I'm not saying that. I'm saying that these are kids. Their brains aren't fully developed yet. And so I want them held accountable. But what else can we do besides throwing them away for 25 to life? Yeah.
So you just answered the question, which was, can our county pursue its own path regarding direct files, even with Prop 21? So I think it starts with what you said, is getting out in the community and starting the conversation to try to make change.
And just with the committee, the subcommittee on the commission, we have interviewed so many different stakeholders. I hesitate to say Bob Lee's name because I know he's all in our prayers, but he gave us 2.5 hours of his time to explain Prop 21 and how the DA looks at cases. And my sense is that the community wants to find a different path and help us find that path. And I think we've gotten that from mental health, from the DA to the public defenders to the court. Help us mm-hmm. find that path so we don't have to go down that one.
So we have another question, which is, wouldn't students who have been through or affected by the system be better informed to work with your community programs? And why do mistakes disqualify them? I think from the perspective of the Youth Violence Prevention Task Force, I can speak to the fact that we've invited court-involved youth to be a voice on the task force. Also, as part of the focus groups, youth who are court-involved will also have their voices heard to contribute to the strategic plan.
May I add?
Sure.
I think one of the places I think that, I also, part of my work is Watsonville Youth City Council and Santa Cruz Youth City Council. And as part of this process, really the youth engagement piece is key. Working with Tracy Benson on bringing, it's also getting the youth, giving them a context about what their suggestions are for is important, and what the impacts are for that. So the education around that is important too. And all of those voices are important. Youth in alternative ed are youth that are doing the best, mm-hmm. the ones that are in college, the students that are in private school. So across the board, we need to hear those different voices. In that piece, I think we need more of that, especially if a 3 to 5 year plan is going to be impacting their community or their right. group, which in Watsonville is like 34% youth are under mm-hmm. 18.
Thank you. So a question for our police department.
I'm sorry, Valerie, okay. I just wanted to ask, mm-hmm. did that question ask about the youth who've made a mistake, their system involved, and why would that mistake count against them? Is that
yeah.
what the question was?
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to go back to a comment that I made, that there exists an employment program where kids they are qualified into the program because they're low income, potentially they're an offender, and they're an ethnic minority. However, because of the requirement to reach outcomes, it's a disincentive to the program, and I'm not naming the program because I don't want to dime it out, because many, many kids do benefit from this program, but it is another screening tool that the administrators of the program have to apply to the youth who they're considering enrolling, because they want to make sure that they can continue to get funding based on the kid's success. So I was saying that there needs to be employment services where there's no expectation of particular outcomes, that it's not kids are going to achieve things on a timeline that's established by adults, because kids don't think like that.
Right. The next question from the audience for the police is, how can the police listen more?
As a ranking officer, I'm going to pass this one on to this guy. I'm kidding.
I clean my ears constantly.
How can we listen more? Well, I think we've got to stop giving orders and start listening. I think for us, at least for me, I can speak for myself, I think education really provided that container for me to be able to listen and to really shut my mouth. And then really getting to know people's values, getting to know where people come from, I think is very important. So I'm not sure if that answers the question. I mean, how do we get to listen? I mean, how do we listen? I think the important thing is for people, at least in my opinion, and I don't know what Joe thinks, but I think for me, if you want me to listen, then come by my office. Call me, email me, text me, do something like that, because I'm ready to listen, and I think you have to find those individuals who are willing to listen and those who are not just have this polarized worldview of my way is the only way, and I'm going to hook and book all day long and take people to jail, because I was once there. And I think we just need to find those officers who are willing to listen to us. That's what I think. Lona, what do you think?
Just to add a small piece, and I don't know what the intent of the question was when they say listen more, but I think it's really just listening to the concerns that the community has. And what we try to do is we have community meetings, and it's whenever that request is made, we try to do them several times a year just throughout the community, but also looking at smaller neighborhoods, smaller areas where we can go and talk to people within the community and listen to what it is that they have on their mind, what challenges they're facing in life with regard to public safety and things of that sort. And I think, I hope I'm answering the question when you talk about listening more, but I think that's the effort that we're making. And really what it comes down to, like Lieutenant Zamora said, you really need to reach out. You need to say, hey, we'd like the police to come because we have some things to say. And if you invite us, we'll be there. I think like anything else, there might not always be an agreement on the way to get there, but what it comes down to is collaboration and really having a discussion how we can work together to achieve the same ultimate goal.
Thank you. So the next question, James Bell talked about changing hearts and minds in addition to policy and practices. What is being done to address how communities think and feel about youth of color? And are teachers and school personnel receiving professional development of culturally relevant discipline practices? So the first part is, how are communities thinking and feeling about youth of color?
Okay. we're thinking that they're just kids, first part. But I think I have to start from the back, which was the cultural competency piece. Everyone's kind of afraid of that. I think the fear comes from, we don't want to say we have biases. Everybody has biases. It just is what it is, as the kids say, right? But it's to recognize them and to not have them impact or influence your decision making. That's the part that's hard. Go ahead and applause, why not? No one ever claps for me. And I think for us, it's a difficult conversation. We're on that path, but I think we have, you know, a long way to go. Even the moment we start saying we got it down is the moment we have to start reevaluating our leadership, because it's going to be an ongoing practice. I mean, I have a bias. You know, if I walk in the room, if I don't see any of my sisters or brothers, then I'm like, man, I should have brought somebody with me, you know? And that's just, and I'm not afraid of that bias. I'm okay to say that. Will that impact my ability to show up? No, I'm going to show up. And as I tell my daughters, when you show up, you show out. But I'm going to do that. But with decision making with teachers or in our community, when we say it's not a problem is when it's our biggest problem. And having those forums like law enforcement is talking about, where we're really having those discussions, and then we're taking that discussion and putting it in action. When you go to a campus, particularly with our district, is there someone there to communicate with the parents in their natural language? When parents walk into a school or an organization, are backs to the door so you can't even greet families? Because someone doesn't speak the language, do you yell and talk louder in your language? Those type of things. And I think that true change is going to come, start from that, just the discussion about it. You know, get it out there. It's the elephant in a room. It's okay. But it's not okay if it influences policies and practices. That's when we have to take a step back and then really come back to the table and have, you know, replace all leadership if we say, yeah, well, it's okay for us to do that. I had a colleague say that one, you know, section of our population of 33, we're from Aptos to Watsonville, that one population didn't deserve to get truancy letters because it's a more affluent community. Well, no, that's not true. Truancy laws are for everyone. Air Cole says you got to be in school. Our policy on time, all day, and every day. That solves the problem right there. So when you start having different practices based on socioeconomics, ethnicity, and you're not willing to really address that, or if you're in a position of power and you do a passive consent by not questioning it and allowing it to go on, you're equally at fault.
Thank you. Okay.
So in our school district, we are offering professional development. We're working closely with a consultant who is helping us really uncover really the root cause of our disproportionality in different areas. We know it's there. We just weren't sure what to do about it. And he's really helping us get to that, the root cause, which is each person and what shifts they need to make and their mindsets about kids. One of the things that has helped us the most is to really learn the term implicit bias and what that means. No one's a racist, but we didn't understand what implicit bias is and what we carry with us all the time. So as we start exploring that and start providing that professional development and opening up that conversation, it allows people really in a non-defensive, non-threatening way to really look at what's real. And to really start saying, wow, I wasn't even aware of that. I had no idea. I didn't know that's how I perceived or everyone perceives or that's how I'm looking at the world. And then people can start relooking and picking that up. So we are providing that professional development. We need it. We can't expect people to know what to do about a problem that's existed for a long time. We are all part of that problem. So we need to bring people in to help us, train us, so that we can keep moving forward.
Thank you. So another question for our educators is specifically for Kenya. What model do you use to engage parents, and what tips would you share for an after-school program currently unsuccessful in engaging parents?
I have to kind of yield, and I'm going to just take her thunder, and Teresa Rodriguez in our district is the parent educator, and we've done several different things, actually. The one thing that we're doing is our padres como socios, or parents as partners, and it's really bringing parents in and working on the relationship and starting from assets, which is what James Bell said. Starting from what is already positive in that family. Our biases allow us to look at a family that is different from our belief system or our value system or the way we're living or our socioeconomic and say, poor family, something's wrong with it. Instead, we're saying, as a family unit, you have strengths. Your values that you convey to your child will help dictate the choices that they make and let's empower you to do that. It is a parent series that parents attend with their students. There's some parts where they separate, then they come back together. Our first session is 40 assets, dealing with that work, and seeing how what students perceive are their assets in their family or their lives, and then what parents perceive that they're providing for their kids in their lives, and then having that discussion, and sometimes it's a bit different. The final series in a meeting in that series is parents really conveying to their kids what their hopes and dreams are for them. And then students conveying it to their parents and them reading love letters to each other and things like that. We don't talk about discipline per se. We don't talk about the negative things that probably got the kids there. We only talk about those strengths and how a family already can support their students and then how we can be a part, an extension of that family and come in and support them that way. For the after-school programs, a lot of things that we do in the school is from 8 to 4, 8 to 3. Right? After-school programs go to 6 o'clock. Really seeing the program as more than just we're keeping kids during critical hours of 3 to 6. And Theresa does this work with our Family Literacy Project in Pajaro Valley in that there's evening activities for families after 6 o'clock. When families are available, with meals and childcare, in the language of the family. And I think that understanding that perception is a lot of things, and not seeing parents as the us them, or oh, here they come, I can't do my job. But if it weren't for students in seats, you wouldn't have a job. So parents are critical to that. And welcoming them in, seeing them as an invited partner, not an intruder. And after school can be a little bit flexible in how they do that, whereas the school day have maybe, you know, restricted funds and things like that. So thinking outside the box and not seeing as we're going to teach you how to deal with your kids, but we are going to work together to help your child succeed. And I think for us, with particularly with our Spanish-speaking families, that opportunity isn't there enough. Ruby worked with our migrant family, so she knows firsthand about getting them in there and having things done in our English learner families. I can't even see that far. But but that I'm sure it said stop. So I would say really thinking outside the box and engaging the parents and doing what's true to your community and your culture, where parents will show up. Don't try and do some blanket one size fits all, because everything doesn't work for everybody.
If I could just say something on that. Just in working with the school district and setting up some, or trying to get some parent engagement into some of our events. Personally growing up, I know that my parents left home at about 5 a.m. and got home at about 7 p.m. So I think it's really important to recognize the audience that you're trying to get in there. And recognize that a lot of these, at least in Watsonville and my personal experience growing up, my parents were extremely tired from working in the fields all day. To get them into a meeting at 5:30, 6 o'clock, it wasn't going to happen. And I think that still exists, so I think it's something to be mindful of.
Mm-hmm. Great, thank you. We'll keep you on the mic, because the last question is for law enforcement, and that is, are gang enhancements biased against black and brown people, and are they necessary to hold people accountable for their crimes?
Joe's going to answer that. I'm kidding. You know, the gang enhancement is a really, when the gang enhancement law first came in and I was on the gang unit, I thought it was a great thing, right? Now we're going to get these violent gang members off the street and we're going to send them to jail because they're doing these violent acts. And I know it's been a really controversial issue. You know, was the question, was it, can you, is it,
repeat it?
Is it necessary, or what was it again?
Are gang enhancements necessary to hold people accountable for their crimes?
I think so. I mean, it's kind of hard to say. I would say that sometimes it is necessary. When you have, gang members committing violent crimes on people, say like a home invasion, a murder, sometimes it is necessary, sometimes it's not. You know, I could tell you that as a young officer on the gang team, I arrested an 18-year-old kid for writing on a wall, and he was writing the name of his gang. Well, that particular crime fell under the gang enhancement criteria. So what did that do to that kid? It raised his bail, and it potentially gave him more time in jail for graffiti, okay? Now you compare that to a violent murder. So is it necessary? I would say sometimes it is, and sometimes it's not. That's my personal opinion, and that's, you know, being on the job for 19 years, 20 years. Sometimes it is necessary, sometimes it's not. So I don't know what you think, Joe, but I'm sure you're gonna tell everybody. Or not.
I think you've answered the question.
Okay, I've answered the question.
Thank you. Would you all give a round of applause to our panelists? Fernando and James will close the session. You all can return to your seats if you like. Thank you.
May I just make a quick announcement? The Community Forum on Justice and Compassion and Hope will be in Watsonville on Wednesday, October 15th from 6 to 8:30 at EA Hall Middle School. You're all invited to come at 6 o'clock.
Look like James, but I'll try to be as exciting. So thank you for coming. We truly appreciate our panelists, and we appreciate your time. This was a lot of time, and it's amazing to see how many people stayed throughout. So we really appreciate everyone coming and being a part of the village, and we hope that you'll follow us into the next steps with our planning and into implementation. We need your voice to help us create the plan, and we need your voice to help us understand how it's going to best be implemented. So I just wanted to say that. And this has been filmed by Community TV, so if there are people that you know that would be interested in this that couldn't be here today, please know that we'll be sending that link out. I also wanted to acknowledge the awkwardness of our index card process, because it's never ideal to not be able to hear directly from you. If there were questions that weren't answered today, we'll collect those, and our intern Julie and coordinator Sarah and I will help get those out to whoever's most appropriate to answer and try to email those answers out. They don't know that yet, so thank you in advance. but we want to make sure that all voices are heard and that we get you your answers. Thanks.
Thank you. Oh,
one more housekeeping thing. Thank you, Sarah, for keeping our heads on straight. You all received an evaluation of this event. Please fill that out. We know it's rather lengthy, but it will really help us understand how to put these events on in the future, and also just how to get back to you with more information, et cetera. So please do fill those out, and we'll collect them on your way out. Fernando.
Great. Well, I want to end and wrap things up and really try to pull together some of the messages that we heard. That's going to help us then drive the process for a strategic plan, but not just the strategic plan for the Youth Violence Task Force, but I think for the well-being of the community as a whole. James is not coming up here. James, I know you probably, I'd prefer to listen to James than myself, but you're going to hear me and not James. But a couple things, though. I want to really thank the panel members, all of you, especially law enforcement. They're an essential part of the balanced approach that our community takes, and I think it says so much about the leadership, the law enforcement, and our community that we had Watsonville PD here. We also had Santa Cruz PD. They're an essential part of this conversation, and it's often challenging to get everyone at the table, but I think that's what makes us unique, so I'm really proud of that fact. I want to say something about James, because his presentations, as you all are thinking, I heard you already saying, were just amazing. But what he always brings to us is new, relevant, vital, and the up-to-date statistics and research. I see a lot of presenters, and after once or twice, I can pretty much say word for word what they're going to say. But James brings us something special to Santa Cruz when he came here. This isn't something that he used 2 years ago or even 2 months ago. So I really appreciate that fact. It's special for us. But I'm sure he does that for everyone else. But I'd like to think it's just us. It's not recycled information. But here are some of the words, the impactful words and ideas that I heard today. And of course, they resonate especially for me, because my role as chief probation officer, are several roles, but one of those is, of course, public safety, recidivism reduction through effective supervision, effective practices. So I need to keep that in mind. That's my lens. But we did, and James did talk a lot about public safety, improving public safety and how we do that. And public safety doesn't mean, we all know this, more suspensions, more expulsions, more jail time. There are other ways to do that, to hold folks accountable. One thing we heard over and over again is asset-based. And be tough on results. It's like a little different than saying tough on crime, response. It's asset-based and then tough on the results that we're getting. So we need to consider this as we move forward with our plan. How do we be asset-based? And how do we leave out some of the elements that really are looking to maybe perhaps increase consequences. There are already lots of consequences. There are a number of laws on the books, a number of procedures and practices. I'm not sure we need more consequences, because those exist and those are happening. It's just that how we use them, and do we use them appropriately and proportionately. One thing I heard James say, and I'm sure all of you agree, is that child well-being is the preferred public safety mechanism. It's really that simple. If our children are feeling good, are feeling safe, are engaged in schools, are civic engaged in, you know, in their communities, they feel supported, loved, just simple things like we do with our own children, we will have a much safer community and much more highly educated community as well. I've been hearing this for the last 2 or 3 years, is the idea or the importance of really working from a base of being trauma-informed, okay? That to me is a no-brainer, that we need to consider the trauma that our kids have experienced, whether in school, in the classroom, as probation officers, whoever. They've been through a lot, and I really think that we need to make advances. There's folks here that are trained in that, but I think that needs to be more widespread, so we all understand it, where it's not just a buzzword, you know, it's trauma-informed. So I think we really need to work hard as a community to get that out there. I think really Santa Cruz is an important place in turning the curve on youth violence. It's I've been working in the community for 25 years, and I haven't seen this large number of folks with passion, expertise, and really interest in joining together and coming up with a solution to improve our community. This is truly an important time for us, an important time that we can continue to turn the curve, because there's a lot of good happening. You saw in Watsonville, Pajaro Valley Unified School District's suspension rates cut by 60%. That is remarkable, and we need to continue that. So it's all of us that can do this. And I think one of the last things I'll say, and it was important, I heard it from someone in the audience commented to James, that how do we get this message to the community, to the grassroots community, where we were talking about Watsonville. So I think that's an important next piece, because really there are folks that aren't hearing this, that are working long hours today that could not be here, parents of the kids that we're working with. So I think that is an important next step. So I want to thank you all for taking your time to be with us today. I appreciate it. And so the next steps will be to take action on the information that we've all learned today. So thank you very much for joining us.